and welcome to PgPool II Performance and Best Practices. My name is Lindsay Hooper, and I'm one of the conference organizers. I'm here with Mohammed Usama, who's a database architect and Postgres consultant at HighGo Software, and he's also a PgPool II core committer. Mohammed's been involved with database development since 2006. He's a core committer for the open source middleware project PgPool II, which we're here to talk about, and he's played a pivotal role in driving and enhancing the product. Prior to coming to open source development, Mohammed was doing software design and development with a focus on systems level embedded development.
Thank you, Lindsay, and good morning, good evening, depending on whichever time zone you are. So for the next 3 hours, I'll be talking about PgPool II, how to set up, and the best practices. Okay, this is me. Lindsay has already given a nice detailed introduction. So I'm Mohammed Usama, you can call me Mohammed, and I'm a senior database architect with HighGo. Prior to that, I was associated with Enterprise DB, and I'm kind of working in Postgres for the last 12 years, and I'm also active member and core committer of PgPool community. I'm the author of some of the exciting PgPool features, and the most notable of them all is the modern watchdog for PgPool 2, which we'll learn as we go through the training. And that is the high availability component of the PgPool 2. Okay, enough about me. Let's get on with the actual content that matters. So this is the agenda for the 2 days training. So basically the training consists of 4 sections. First, I'll give you a brief overview of PgPool 2, what it does, its architecture, its value proposition. Next, we'll move on to the simple example walkthrough that is related to setting up the basic PgPool 2 setup. By then, I'm hoping we'll have an idea on how to get started with PgPool 2 and set up the basic cluster with 2 Postgres backends. So after that, we'll try to build on that example we have just done and try to add a new standby Postgres backend to the cluster without disturbing the service. And yeah, for all these examples, I've added a small how-to videos in the slides in hope to make things easier to understand. Initially, I wanted to include some interactive exercises, but then I realized we may run out of time in doing so. And would not be able to cover all the things. So let's see if the videos do any good. Right, in the later part of the training, after the example walkthrough, I'll discuss the main features of PgPool 2, which would include load balancing, connection pooling, authentication, security, watchdog, management interface of PgPool 2. And for each of these features, I'll try to cover the configuration and the best practices and their usability. And finally, if we still have time, I'll try to touch on some of the more exciting features and PgPool 2 admin. Right, I hope you'll enjoy the training and get something useful out of it. And yeah, we'll have a question answer session as Lindsay told you at the end of the training, but you can also stalk me or just type in the question in the chat window at any time and I'll try to answer that as best as I can. Okay, so PgPool 2. Let's start with it. Like, what is PgPool 2? Well, PgPool 2 is around like more than a decade now, and I'm sure most of you already have a good idea about what PgPool 2 and what it does. So I'll try to be quick and go through the slide. So it's a cluster management tool dedicated for Postgres and supports wide range of Postgres versions, like from 7.4. This is when that was the version when PgPool 2 was created, and up to the latest version, that is 12. And it also supports the Postgres Drive products like Amazon Aurora, Redshift, and proprietary flavors like Enterprise DB's EPAS. So yeah, and it has the same license as Postgres, so you can just pull the source code, make your own changes, and make it like modify it and like market it and whatever you want to do with it. So yeah, and it is used for managing the Postgres cluster and does have the functionality of automatic failover. We'll learn about that. And you can also attach the new server, new standby or repaired servers after resyncing it without using the online recovery or a manual methods. We'll discuss those. And this is pretty much it. And other than that, it provides a connection pooling, query cache, watchdog, that is a high availability component, and load balancing. Okay, so from the architecture point of view, PgPool is a proxy or a middleware server. It sits between Postgres instance and the client application and understand the Postgres front-end and back-end protocol. That means that the application connecting to Postgres through PgPool 2 see no difference and require no additional changes or modification to work with PgPool 2. Also, since like Postgres, because of its license and feature, as you know, has been adopted by many companies to create their own modification, as we discussed in the previous slide. So it kind of works with all flavors of Postgres, like AWS, Aurora, and Enterprise DBs, EPS, and Redshift, and so many others. Okay, so if you talk about architecture, just like Postgres architecture, it also PgPool also uses a multi-process architecture, and each child process of PgPool 2 handles one client connection at a time. But unlike Postgres, the life cycle of the child process that handles a client connection does not end with the client disconnection. PgPool 2 spans the configured number of child processes at the startup time, and each child process keep waiting for the client connection. And as you know, while in Postgres, like Postgres and Postmaster main process listens for the client connection, and as soon as the new connection is received, a new child process is spawned. We call it backend, and that connection is handed to that backend, which serves it until the client disconnects and that backend dies with the client connection. So this is a kind of a difference. Like, both are multi-process architectures, but PgPool 2 spawns all the child process at the startup, and each child process waits for the connection, while in Postgres, like the processes are spawned as they are needed. So this is a very important architectural aspect of PgPool 2 that needs to be considered when we are creating a PgPool cluster, because this affects the total number of concurrent client connection PgPool can handle. Similarly, it affects the number of pooled Postgres backend connections. We'll definitely discuss this in detail when we'll be discussing the connection pooling of PgPool 2. Other than the child process, which handles the client connection, PgPool also spawns some other processes for internal tasks like health checking, watchdog, replication check, live check, and again, the thing we'll discuss this in detail. Okay. So this is the process structure diagram. I will just quickly go through it. The green rectangle in the middle, upper middle corner, it's the main process that is responsible for spanning all the other processes. And it also performs some tasks like monitoring the child. If any child goes down, it respawns it, deliver the signals. And most important of all, it performs the failover and failback operations on the backend nodes. Then the pink process on the left, these are the child processes we just talked about. They handle the client connection. They are the actual workhorse of the client connections. And then all the blue ones on the right and in the middle, they can be categorized as worker processes, and they used to perform, like they are used for different kind of tasks. Like some of them perform the health checking of the backend node, and Each backend health check is performed by a separate process. That means if you have three backend nodes configured for health checking, then PgPool will spawn three health check processes. Well, this is the recent change in PgPool 2. Previously, the health checking was done by the PgPool main process, but then we did not have the luxury of fine-tuning the health checking for each backend node. Other than the health check processes, PgPool spawn PCP process, which listens for the PCP client connections, and other child processes like and one more thing, like the PCP process also spawns its own child process. Like for whenever a new PCP command arrives, a separate process is spawned by PCP server process, and that command is handled by that process, and when that command finishes, the PCP child process dies with it. So yeah, other than that, there are replication child processes, watchdog check process as well. So this is just overall view of like what is how the multi-process architecture of PgPool 2 looks like from the top. All right, so yeah, this is like how you can get get up and running with the PgPool 2. The current version of PgPool 2 is 4.1.x. The third digit would be like points to the point releases. And we release one major version every year normally with each new release of Postgres. Then there are many point releases in between. The source code can be fetched from the Git repository that is hosted on the Postgres Git server. Then you can see that I've listed some links for the documentation in PgPool 2 admin. Well, the PgPool admin is a GUI-based management console for the PgPool 2 and can be used to perform tasks like online recovery and configuration. But to be fair, the management console hasn't got, the management console hasn't got much attention lately, and you may find it not very robust and attractive. Just recently, the community has started working on the next-gen PgPool admin, and hopefully in a year time, we'll have a much better GUI, so stay tuned for that. And finally, there's a link of the task list wiki page. If someone is interested in working on some feature for PgPool 2 or wants to get an idea of what community is working on currently, they can just go to that link and we list everything we are working on this wiki page. Okay. So yeah, these are the links for mailing list, bugs, reporting system, YAML repository. Similar to Postgres, PgPool has general and hackers list, where journal is more for a user level discussion and hacker is for sending the patches, discussing new feature and more code like stuff. So yeah, just in case you need to like send something to the community. Okay, so now coming to the actual training, I think most of us must be already familiar with the Dockers and Docker environment. Well, in short, Docker is just a platform as a service product that uses OS virtualization to deliver software in package called containers. And as you know, like Dockers are lightweight and can be scripted, so they are the best choice to create and test the cluster with multiple nodes. And for that reason, I've created a Docker-based examples for this training, and I've placed them on my GitHub account, and all the example walkthroughs will do in the training. They also refer to the same Docker environment. So basically, the PgPool 2, yeah. Okay, so I've listed like I've created three examples, and they are all hosted on my GitHub account, which I've given the link to. And the first one is pgpool_2pg_node setup. That is like in this example, you'll see it sets up PgPool 2 node with two Postgres backends. And you can use this to test a new standby node to add a new node to the cluster without disturbing the service. Similarly, PgPool 3PG node setup, this is like the PgPool setup with three backend nodes. And the last one, PgPool 2 watchdog example, it sets up the PgPool with the watchdog. Like we'll learn this when we go through. So when watchdog is involved, you install multiple PgPool 2 nodes. So in this example, the setup used three PgPool 2 nodes and two Postgres backend nodes. So total five systems work together, and you can just try that out and to test the different features of watchdog and other. Okay, so. So if you want to try the example, you would need a Docker engine and Docker Compose installed on your system. Both are part of the standard Docker for desktop installer, which can be downloaded from the Docker's website. So you can go on and try that. And for running each example, and I've also included the README in the which is placed along with the examples. But it's just very simple. You just go into the example directory, you just write docker compose build and then docker compose up, and you'll have the working system with everything set up. Okay, just little note on the example environment. All the examples are based on CentOS 6, but of course you can change it to the Linux flavor of your liking by a very little modification. Also for the Postgres instances, the example deploys PG11 and uses the latest available PgPool 2 version, that is PgPool 2 4.1. So yeah, this is about the all about the resources for the training. So coming to the clustering mode and scope of the training, okay, like you may already know, like PgPool 2 can be configured in three different modes. The first one is the master slave mode. In this mode, PgPool 2 expects that Postgres backend node configured with PgPool 2 have the active replication working between them. And one of the nodes in master or primary is a master or primary, while the rest of them are connected to that primary master, but whatever you like to call it, node as a standby or a slave node. Personally, I like to be name this parameter as primary standby mode rather than the master slave mode, but that's how things are. It's called that just before I even know the PgPool 2. So we have to live with the master slave mode right now. Anyhow, in master slave mode, PgPool 2 expects that the primary Postgres node can serve both read and write statements, while standby nodes are actually hot standbys and can serve the read queries. Again, the master slave mode has two sub modes. I've listed them there, stream and Sloney. This is to tell PgPool 2 what kind of replication is configured between Postgres system. But most of the time we'll deal with the streaming replication mode, and that means PG server and are using the built-in streaming replication. Sloney was used for replication before Postgres had its own replication, and since PgPool 2 is quite old, so it still supports that mode. Maybe there are people who still use Sloney for the replication, I don't know. Okay, the second mode is replication mode, which is basically which basically do not expect the configured backend of Postgres server to be using any kind of replication. So PgPool 2 tries to do the replication by itself when you set it in the replication mode. Pretty nifty, right? So as the name suggests, in this mode, PgPool 2 does the statement-based replication, and it does this by sending the write statements to all configured backends and load balance the read queries. Again, it was quite popular back in the days, but when there was no standard application solution for Postgres, but now, like, I don't think so. It's very much in use these days. And the last one is the raw mode. And in this mode, you just use the PgPool 2 as a connection pooler and proxy server between client and PgPool 2. And it does not expect like that the servers connected to that are actually replicated or something. So this training and all the examples only focus on the master slave mode with streaming replications, and that is the most popular and most used clustering mode with PgPool 2 currently. So we'll just focus on the first one, and yeah, I'll just and give the overview, maybe if the time permits, about the other modes. Okay, right, before we get on with the actual configuration and setup or discuss various functions of PgPool 2, I want to discuss a little bit about the value proposition of PgPool 2, like why and when we need to use the PgPool 2. So I think that's a valid question. So basically, PgPool 2, as the name suggests, was originally built for connection pooling, and over the years a lot has gone into it, and after the addition of load balancing module, it is used more as a load balancer than as a pooler. So maybe we'll change the name from PG load balancer or something, I don't know. Yeah, and we all know that pooling in the connection gives performance benefit for a lot of workloads, especially if your workload is kind of like each connection do a very small amount of work and then disconnect and then new connections come in. So for that kind of workload, the pooling gives you a good performance, and yeah. So another good use case of PgPool II is it can add an extra layer of security to your database system. Like we can hide the database engine from public network by placing it in DMZ zone, demilitarized zone, what we call it, and let the PgPool II interact with external traffic. And we can hide the server in the Postgres server in our local network. So these are two good uses of PgPool II, but the most useful of all is the load balancer. As they say, data is the new gold, you know. So no matter the use case, small or big, every database system installed in the real world requires redundancy and fault tolerance. And like relying on a single system and hoping nothing will ever go wrong just doesn't work. So in short, like depending on the organization disaster recovery strategy, we all deploy multiple replicated database. And if you talk about Postgres, more often than not, we use streaming replication to have a real-time copy ready to switch over to guard against the failures. And the streaming replication and primary standby is pretty much the only feasible way currently available to build the high availability data Postgres, as there is no good production ready robust multi-master system that exists today for the Postgres. So we all use master slave or master standby kind of configuration. So what this means is effectively when we deploy a primary standby replicated system, we end up utilizing 50% or less resources available to us, as the standby Postgres just sits there and keep waiting for something bad to happen with the primary so that it can take over. So this is where the PgPool II comes in real handy. Like it can take off the real load. it can take off the read load from the primary database server and shift it to the idle standby. And this not only give the performance boost, but also help in reducing the cost and system requirement for the server. For example, if a particular workload requirement for a database system was to serve 1,000 concurrent clients, and let's say it requires X amount of performance out of the system. So distributing the load would mean that same number of concurrent clients would only need X over 2, or maybe you can call X over 1.5 amount of performance from the system. So you can install a lower cost system, just saying like, so having a load balance is kind of a must have, and it saves the cost and gives a performance. Yeah, then another question comes in, like if you talk about load balancer, we can find many other solutions currently exist in the market, but what makes the PgPool II most attractive and obvious choice is that it does the seamless read-write split. That means you don't need to implement or change anything on the application side to unleash the load balancing capability. All you need to do is to plug in the PgPool II between client and server, and you get it working. You get the working load balancer. Other solutions either require modification in SQL statements or use a separate read-write connection to perform load balancing. So the PgPool II load balancer is a complete solution which doesn't require any more work. You just need to plug it in. So I think this is the best use case of PgPool II. Okay, so first thing first, let's start with the overview of PgPool configuration parameter, how we can interact with them and stuff like that. So this is just a trivial stuff. I will try to go over it as quickly as possible. Well, the PgPool configuration is inspired by Postgres configuration system. So PgPool.conf follows the same syntax and format as Postgres.conf. So it supports four kind of parameters: Boolean, numeric, string, and enumerated. You all are familiar with each one of them. So yeah, in general, there are three categories of configuration parameters. Change in value requires a restart. The other kind, they can be changed by reloading the configuration. And the third kind is they can be changed within the current session. We'll discuss like how we can change the parameters in current session. Okay. So, just a sec. I have my chair. Okay. Okay, and there's a little difference between Postgres and PgPool configuration parameters, since because of nature of PgPool 2, we require to configure similar parameters for different nodes. Like we require to configure multiple Postgres backend nodes with PgPool 2. So for that purpose, PgPool 2 uses a node ID or node number suffix with the parameter name. For example, when we want to configure the backend host name for two Postgres servers, then the first one will be configured by backend underscore hostname and zero. The suffix zero means that we are configuring the zeroth backend. And then the second one can be done using the backend underscore hostname one. And the suffix starts from zero and can be negative number and goes up to the, I think most of the parameters can suffix can go up to 255. So yeah, 0 to 255 and can be a negative number. So this is a bit different from Postgres. Like Postgres doesn't follow this convention, but for some requirement in PgPool 2 we have to do this. Okay. So like, this is again kind of a trivial stuff, but how we can change or interact with the configuration parameters. The first thing is like you can just write them in pgpool2.conf file, pgpool.conf file, and similar to it is similar to postgres.conf, and it is located at the etc pgpool.conf. This is the default location, but you can also specify it using the -f startup parameter, and you can place it anywhere you like to. So yeah. So this is again the hash at start of the line marks the the particular line is commented out, and people will not read that configuration parameter. And yeah, this is the thing which PgPool 2 has added, and we have added like two new commands in PgPool 2. That is similar to the show commands and set commands of Postgres, and PgPool 2 space show and then configuration parameter name. This gives the value of the PgPool 2 configuration parameter, and this is similar to the show command of Postgres. Just you need to add a PgPool 2 before the show, and then you can also show the configuration parameter groups, PgPool 2, PgPool space show, then configuration parameter groups. The group consists of a related configuration parameter. For example, if you write PgPool show backend, it will give you all the backend related configuration you have done in the PgPool configuration file. And again, just like show all, we have PgPool show all command. Okay, again, like if you want to change some parameters value on the go, you can use PgPool set command. And this is again similar to Postgres set command, and this sets the value of session local configuration parameter for current session. The change value gets reset to default once the user's session ends. And you can see the synapses of the command. Like this is what we can use, and there are some PgPool reset configuration parameter, and PgPool reset all. These reset the parameter to the default value, but what is set in the PgPool.conf file. All right, so let's start with configuring our first PgPool 2 setup with one primary and one standby node. This is what we want to create: one PgPool 2 node that is connected to a primary and a standby server, Postgres server, and the streaming replication is working between primary and standby. So let's try to create the setup as shown in the diagram. Again, as I've told you, like all the example walkthrough are like done on the Docker setups, and you can also try that out from using the Docker environment I've uploaded on the GitHub page. So the first step, we need to set up a primary and a standby Postgres servers. So you have a primary Postgres server, and the first thing you need to do is to create a replication slot on the master. We call PG master is the master Postgres server, and PG slave is the standby, or PG standby is the standby server. And so you can create create the replication slot by using select PG create physical replication slot, and then you have to give the slot name, and we use the PG underscore standby underscore one as a slot name. Okay. I hope you can see the video. So on the bottom of the slide, and I've created a video by doing in the same steps. So, okay. So once you have the replication slot set up, the next thing you need to do is you need to take a base backup on the standby server, just to make sure like we have to we have a copy of the Postgres data, and that is replicated. So for that, we'll use the PG underscore base backup, and and create a standby or a slave server on the second machine, that is PG slave. Okay, once you're done, just go on and start the Postgres service on the PG slave, and you can do it by service Postgres and start, because we are using the CentOS 6, so, and install the Postgres using the RPM. So just writing the service Postgres and start will start the service. And next thing we need to do is we need to configure the pgpool.configuration. And for the first thing is we need to configure backend hostname for both master and the standby. Since you can write IP address here, but I've already configured the host names in the Docker environment. So we'll just be using the host names. So backend underscore hostname zero will get, you'll assign PG master, and to backend underscore hostname one, we'll use PG slave. So this will do the backend configuration. That's it, because we are using the default ports 5432. If your server is running on a different port, then we can change the port number as well or anything. But for now, we'll just set up the host names, and we are good for the configuration. Other than that, set the load balance mode to on, and then master underscore slave underscore mode to on. These are the two configuration you need to change. And load balance mode is not all that important. Everything will work fine, but only the load balancing will not work. But let's do it right now. So yeah. Another thing we need to do here is we need to enable the health checking and configure the health check. We'll use it. We may require it later on when we'll be testing the failover and failback scenarios. And for that, we'll set the health check, health underscore check underscore user. And we have created a PgPool user in the database, or you can use any user. You can create a new user and put the username here, and then you need to put the health check password so that PgPool II health check can connect to the server using the username and password. So here I've written AES password, and I'll try to explain like what is AES password and why we are doing that. So to enable the health check, we need to we'll change the health check underscore period to 10. You can change it to any value. Setting it to zero disables it. Otherwise, currently we'll set 10 seconds for health check period and 10 seconds for health check timeout. And the other thing we need to do is we need to set the SR check period. SR stands for streaming replication. So again, setting SR check period to zero will disable the streaming replication health checking, streaming replication period checking. Otherwise, setting it to 10 means it will PgPool to do will check for streaming replication lag every 10 seconds. And similarly, as for health check database, we need to set up streaming replication check database. We use Postgres for database for that purpose. And SR check user and SR check password. Again, these are user and password of a Postgres, the user that is created on the Postgres site. Again, we are using AES password. I'll explain it later. So this is all we need to do. That if you are trying like if you try to do that, then everything is working fine. Like we have this setup now, PgPool 2 with one primary and one standby node is ready to use, and the active load balancing is working in that. So let's discuss some important notes on the configuration we have done so far. Passwords, like this is the very important thing. Like this is, so if you go through the PgPool configuration file, or you'll see PgPool 2 requires 4 database users to perform its internal tasks, and these are health check user, SR check user, which is streaming replication check user, recovery user, and WD life check user. You might not need all at every time, but these are the 4 users that is required by PgPool to perform the specific tasks. So yeah, we can use a single we can create one database user in Postgres backend, and we can use that user for each of these tasks. We just configure the same user for each parameter, but yeah, for auditing and security requirement, we may need to use a different user for each one, each separate task. Again, that depends like what kind of the requirements are. So the thing is, setting a plain text password in pgpool.conf is a security risk. We all know that, like if anyone can get hold of the configuration file, they'll know the database user, a database password, and like the configuration files are not all that protected like the other things. So it's not recommended to use the plain text passwords. So since version 4.0, PgPool 2 allows to use MD5 or AES encrypted passwords in pgpool.conf. Before that, there was no way. Like before version 4.0, there was no way. You have to write the actual database password in the configuration file, and that was a security risk. So I decided to work on that feature, and I implemented this particular feature in 4.0. Now you can use MD5 or AES encrypted passwords. So yeah, the pg_md5 utility that comes with PgPool 2 can be used to create MD5 password. And similarly, there's pg_enc utility that is added in Postgres in PgPool 4.0 along with the feature that can be used to create encrypted passwords. And the passwords are encrypting using AES 256 bit encryption. And yeah, you can just whenever you use the particular password type in PgPool conf file, the like for MD5 passwords, the password must be prefixed with MD5 prefix, and similarly for AES, the password must be prefixed with AES. That's how PgPool knows like what kind of encryption the password is using. This is just a simple like how we can use a pg_enc utility to create an encrypted password. You just execute the pg_enc and write the DB password, and okay, so as we know, like it's AES encryption, and for doing encryption we need a key. Without key we cannot do the encryption. So for that purpose, and the PgEnc utility and also the PgPool 2, they expect that the key file is present in /home/postgres.pgpool-key. This is the default location of the key file. So whichever file is present there, PgPool 2 will read that file and use the content of that file as a key to encrypt the passwords. And of course, you can override the path which is used for the key file path, or you can provide the key using the environment variable. We'll discuss that in detail. But yeah, this is the point. Like PgPool or PgE_enc uses the key file to encrypt the passwords, and then that same key file is required by PgPool 2 when it has to decrypt the password to use it to connect to database. So what, just execute the pg_enc, type in the password, and you'll get the encrypted password, and just copy paste that password in the PgPool config file, and you're good to go. So this is a recommended way of using the passwords in PgPool conf file. Okay, so So now we have created a single node PgPool II instance, which is connected to two backend nodes. Now let's use the same setup and try to add a second standby or a third Postgres node without interrupting the service step by step. Like this is what we have done in the previous example walkthrough, and this is now what we'll try to make it to. Previously we have only one standby and one primary node. Now we'll use the same setup. We'll add the standby to the existing setup. So PgPool does provide a way to add a new standby node without interrupting the service, and there are basically two ways to do that. One is you can manually configure the standby, attach it to the PgPool II, and the other way is online recovery. So we'll look into both of them one by one. So first, the manually attaching. Again, for the example walkthrough, we'll use the same Docker environment and add another third node, Postgres backend, as I told. So this is what we need to do if we want to manually attach a new standby node. So as we have done in the previous example, first thing, we need to create a replication slot in the master database or the primary database. And we use the same command pg_create_physical_replication_slot, and let's give it a name pg_standby2. So yeah, and then the second step is we need to create an online backup, and that can be done by using pg_base_backup. And you can see in the video, like I'm performing this, I've recorded the steps we have done. And once you have a backup ready, just go on and start the Postgres service. And so till that point, we have a third, the second standby node connected to the to the master node, but that node is not present in the, like that node is not configured in the PgPool II, so it can be used by PgPool II for load balancing and stuff. So after doing this, just verify the master node has picked up a new standby, and we can use it using the PG stat replication view and select from there. You can see in the video, like our standby 2 is up and running. So now let's add it in the PgPool configuration. So we don't need to stop or do anything with the PgPool 2. Just go on and edit the pgpool.conf file. And as we have done in the previous step, add the second standby node. And we can do it by adding the configuration parameter for backend_hostname2. And we'll write the PgPool node, because the third system we have we are using is its name is PgPool node. So write that in the hostname configuration, and we'll leave everything as it is. The port number is default port number, which is 4, 5, 4, 3, 2, and just leave everything intact. Just go on and save the PgPool conf file and reload the PgPool configurations. So to reload the configuration, we use service PgPool reload, and that will make the PgPool to reload the configuration file. And doing so will not affect any connection disruption or anything. So we have just done that, and now just connect to the PgPool to see if the third node is like picked up by PgPool 2 or not. So for that, we'll use show_PgPool2nodes command, and you can see like the third node is configured, but its status is coming up as down. This means although the node is already configured in PgPool 2, but it is not ready to use by the PgPool 2 as now. So this is, we have done show nodes. Okay, so what we need to do is we need to attach that newly added standby 2 to the PgPool 2. And we can do it by using pcp_attach_node command. This is the utility that comes with PgPool 2. You just need to execute the utility using and provide the node ID, because we have added backend_hostname2. So you have to put the same node ID in the PCP attach node command, and yeah, you're ready to go. So let's log in again and see if the node is attached. Here you see that the node is up and running, and it is now it can be used for load balancing and everything. And we have added a new node without interrupting the service. Sorry. So, okay. Now this was the manual method where we did everything manually and then attached it with the PgPool II using the PCP attach node command. Now let's try to do the same using the online recovery. That basically online recovery performs the same steps as what we have done in manual way, but it automates doing that. And one of the benefit of using the online recovery is that you don't need a physical or you don't need access to the systems, and you can just do it using the commands or the PgPool II client rather than actually intervening on the master node or standby node. So yeah. So let's try to do the online recovery again, and we'll use the same setup what we created in the first example, where we had one primary and one standby node. And for online recovery to work, PgPool II comes with the PgPool_recovery Postgres extension. We need to install that extension on the master server. And then another requirement is that we need a passwordless SSH connection enabled between master and new server. New server is where we want to restore or we want to create the second standby node. And then we need to create two scripts, that is recovery first state script. And that script should be placed in the master node's data directory. And the second is the remote start script. Again, that needs to be present in the master node data directory. So this is kind of done once, like whenever we are setting up the PgPool II cluster, we create the scripts and place them there, so that whenever we need to add a new node, we already have the scripts placed in the master node, and same scripts will be used to recover no matter how many nodes we want to recover from there. Okay, so let's discuss about recovery first state script. Like this is executed by PgPool II, and I've written the exact select command which PgPool II use to execute the script on the master or on the primary server. So this PgPool_recovery is the function that is added by the PgPool recovery extension. When we install the extension, we get this function in the database, and it gets passed with recovery first stage script. That is the script we have replaced in the data directory. And then other parameters are recovery host name. That is the host name we want to recover the standby node on. Recovery data directory, again the data directory where the data of the standby will reside. And then the master backend port and node ID. Node ID is whichever the node ID we want to recover it to. Like in this example, we'll use node ID 2 because we already have node ID 0, which is primary, node ID 1, which is standby 1, and we'll recover the standby 2 on node ID 2. And then recovery backend port, this is the port number which will be used for the recovered node. So okay, so what we do in the recovery first state script. So basically the responsibility of recovery first state script is to create the replication slot on master PG node, which we done in the previous example. We done that manually by using PG_create replication slot command. And then it has to perform the base backup. Again, we did that manually previously, but now this is the responsibility of this script to do that. Then the third thing it needs to do is to set up the appropriate Postgres.con configuration file. And for example, if you want to use a different port number, we can specify that in the pgpool2.conf, and then the recovery script needs to update that in the postgres.configuration file. And finally, we need to set up the recovery.conf so that the standby should point to the correct primary node. So this is just a snippet of the example recovery first script we normally used. So you can see like in first we use select pg underscore create physical replication slot command. This will create the slot on the master server, and then we SSH to the destination port host which will host the standby to. And then we use PG based backup and takes the online backup. So this is, and I have included the example scripts in the Docker environments, and they are also present on the PgPool website. So you normally don't need to change much in the recovery first aid script. So you can just download a script from the PgPool 2 official site, and you can use that after changing the name or maybe SSH key paths, and that you're ready to go with that. The second script that is required for the online recovery to work is the pgpool underscore remote underscore start. So this script gets executed after the recovery first stage command, and again this script is also executed by the pgpool underscore recovery extension we need that to be installed on the master. And then I've written the exact select command which executes this pgpool remote start, and that is select pgpool remote start, then the recovery host name, and then the recovery data directory. So what it does is it basically starts the server standby node. And normally we use just pgctl to in the script. This is the sample script, and this is how it just need to execute one simple command, and that is pgctl -l or whatever the way you need to start the Postgres server. You can use the service script or something like that. So these are the two scripts we need. Okay. Now let's configure the pgpool2.conf for the online recovery. And for the backend node information, we just do the same thing. We set the backend host name, that is pgpool node. This is the server host address where we want to recover the standby node. And then we need to set up the data directory again, backend underscore data directory node 2. That is where we want to place the data standby data. And then we need to configure the recovery user. We have already discussed like we should provide the recovery user and username, and then the recovery password again. Password for that user, the recovery user, and we can use AES encrypted passwords or MD5 encrypted password. We can also use a simple text password, but that is not recommended. And okay, so once we are done with that, then we need to write in the recovery first sage command, and that is the name of the script without the sh prefix. So since our recovery you need to put in the name of this recovery first stage script. And this is recovery underscore first underscore stage. Just put the name in the configuration parameter, and next thing, you are good to go. So this is just example like of doing the same. First, we created a extension that is pgpool recovery extension, create extension pgpool underscore recovery. That will do that. And then after editing the pgpool configuration file, we will execute the PCP underscore recovery underscore node. And you can see in example, like here we are basically adding the backend information. This is backend hostname underscore hostname 2. And then we set the weight, we set the data directory, and In this example, I'm using IP instead of hostname. So you can use either IP addresses or hostname. So we are good with the editing the configuration file. Now, next thing we need to do is we need to reload the PgPool configuration. And yeah, this is done. Just verify if the PgPool has picked up the new node. And you can see now the third node is added, but it is still showing as down because we haven't executed a recovery command. And just go in and use PCP underscore recovery node and put in the node ID and username and password for the PCP system. Okay, PCP recovery node command successful. So we are good. And we just show node, and you can see the third node is added and it is up and running and attached to PgPool too. So now if you want to recover another node, just go on edit the PgPool configuration file. You don't need to take any backup. You don't need to log into the system. Just do that and you execute the PCP recovery node command and you'll have another standby attached and up and running in no time. So this is how we can use PCP online recovery and PCP attached node to add a new standby node in the existing setup without interrupting the service. And while we were doing that, the user may be connecting to the PgPool 2 and PgPool 2 would be serving them without any disruption. So this is a good way if you want to add a new node, if you want to add a recovered node or something. So next thing let's discuss about backend health and failover. So backend health check. As the name suggests, health check is a process which periodically connects to the configured Postgres backends to detect any error on the server or network. When the error is detected, PgPool 2 performs either a failover or a degeneration, depends on the backend configuration. So we'll discuss like when the degeneration is performed and when the failover is performed. So these are the configuration parameter which we can use to tune the health checking. So the first one is health check timeout, and it configures the timeout and second for connecting to the backend Postgres. This is similar to the TCP/IP connection timeout, but we want to detect the error quickly. So this health check timeout sets the time which our TCP connect call should wait before giving up. So this is health check timeout, and then the health check period, it is an interval between health checks. And if you set it to the zero, then this will disable the health check. Again, that is not recommended, and we'll discuss why it is not recommended. So then the health check max retry is, again, if this parameter sets if the health check fails, how many number of tries we should perform before marking is as a failure or as a node is down. So this is again an integer value, and you setting it to zero mean the first health check failure would mark the node as down, and it will go on and perform the failover. And then health check retry delay, again, it configures the number of seconds between doing the successive health check retries. These are the three parameters we already discussed and worked with. The first one is health check database. So you can set if you want the health check process to connect to a particular database. And normally what we do is we create a database, let's name it PgPool 2, and we don't put any data into that for just in case if even somebody get access to that database, then it should have no real data. So this parameter sets the database name which health check will try to connect to. Leaving it empty will make PgPool 2 try to connect to Postgres database first, and in case of failure it will try to connect to template one database, and if that fails too, then it will give up and say it's a failure. Then health check user, this is the user that should exist in the Postgres server side, and the health check password, again, this is the password for that user, and you should use encrypted password here. Okay, Okay, so basically, all these health check parameters we just described, like health check timeout, health check period, health check max retries, all these parameters, you can use these parameters with and without suffix, node ID suffix. The parameter value, if you use without suffix, like you just write health check underscore timeout is equal to 10, that means that this is a global setting for health check timeout, and each health backend node will use the same health check timeout. But if you use a suffix, then for example, if you use health check underscore timeout and 1, this will set the timeout value for only backend node 1. Rest of the nodes will keep using the default values, and the value where we use the suffix will override the global value for that particular parameter. So by doing this, you can use a different configuration for different backend nodes. For example, if we want to have 10 second in between retries for backend node 1 and 5 second between retries for backend node 2, because of any reason, because of the network situation or because of the vicinity, or so we can do that using the suffix at the end of that particular parameter, health check parameter name. So that's pretty much about configuring the health check. Let's come to the automatic failover part. So automatic failover. This is a mechanism in PgPool 2 to detect problematic nodes and reconfigure the standby nodes to follow the new primary. Like for example, if your system is working with one primary node or two standby nodes, and your primary node goes down, so the automatic failover mechanism of PgPool will kick in, and it will detach the problematic node. If it happens to be primary, then it will just remove the primary node from the system and reconfigures. And it, first thing it will do is it will select one of the standby nodes and make it the new primary node, and then reconfigure all the remaining standby nodes so that they can follow the new newly promoted primary node. So the automatic failover mechanism or the failover thing can be triggered in three ways. The first thing is when the health check monitor the node failure. The health check we discussed previously, if it detects the problem, it will inform the PgPool 2 that it is not able to connect to the particular node, and the PgPool 2 go on and start the failover procedure on the failed node. The second is if a reading writing failure to the Postgres backend happens. Again, this is configurable. There is a parameter in PgPool conf that is failover on backend error. If you set it to on, only then the reading writing failure on a Postgres backend will cause the failover. Otherwise, that error will be ignored. I mean, that connection will be terminated, on which the error has occurred, but the PgPool will not perform the failover. I personally do not recommend to use this parameter, and we'll discuss like why. And but you can do that. Like if you want a failover to happen anytime if the reading writing fails on the backend, you can do that. And the third way, like by a remote PgPool 2 node. If you are using watchdog and everything is working fine on your side, but somehow or the other PgPool 2 nodes connected to the watchdog, they see some problem in connection or in any of the node, they can inform the other node so that then your node will also perform to go on and perform the failover. Again, we'll discuss that further in detail. So this is just to show how the failover works. So this is the diagram shows the setup we have. Like we have one PgPool node and one primary and two standby nodes connected to it, and they all work, the streaming replication is working between them. So let's suppose that some problem happens with our primary and we are not able to reach it anymore. So what happens is one of the standby will get promoted to the new primary node. If you see that the last bottom one node, which was standby node in the previous, is now selected as a primary node, and Postgres will, the PgPool will make that third node as a new primary node and make the second standby or the center one to follow the new primary node. So this is all done by automatic failover mechanism. And similarly, if primary node just keeps on working, but somehow or the other the standby node fails, then no failover will happen. The failover mechanism will kick in, but it will not alter any system configuration. It will just go on and remove the problematic standby node from the cluster, and your system will keep working without disruption. And now with two nodes, previously we had three nodes. So the standby node failure is just handled seamlessly. Okay, so these are some related configuration parameters, and first of all are backend node flags, and these are set for these can be set for each backend node, and backend underscore flag, and then the node ID suffix. And so if you set it to allow to failover, that means that node, if that node fails, or if the health check on that node fails, then perform the failover. And you can also set it to disallow to failover. When you set the backend flag to disallow to failover, then what happens is PgPool 2 will try to, even in case of failure, PgPool will not perform the failover, and it will keep trying to continue to connect to the problematic node. And until that node comes back alive again, the service will not be stopped. Like you cannot connect to PgPool 2. So that is there for the historical reason. I don't think so. That is much useful. So most of the time we'll be dealing with a lot of failover backend flags. So this is the other thing is failover on backend error. As I discussed, I don't recommend using it. When this is set to on, PgPool to consider the reading writing error on Postgres backend connection as backend node failure and triggers a failover. When this is set to off, PgPool will only report an error and disconnect the session in case of a reading writing error. So the reason we don't want to use this is because this parameter is too aggressive, and even a small glitch or even a very smallest of the problem can make the node to do for failover, and eventually failover is a very expensive process, and we don't want to be doing failover on the small glitches. So health checking is the better way for detecting errors and triggering the failover. Then there's another related configuration parameter that is called detach false primary. And again, this is pretty new one, and I think it was added in 4.0. And before that, we don't have that. And what it does is it automatically removes the false primary backend from the cluster. And there can be situations when you can have multiple primary nodes because of some misconfiguration or some other problems. So you don't want to have a split brain on the backend side. Like you don't want to have two different versions of data. So this is very, very useful when detecting the false primary and removing it from the server. So again, it only works in the streaming replication mode and stops the detection process when PgPool 2 doesn't find any primary node. Like if you don't have any primary node, then there is no point looking for the false primary, because at that point we don't have even a real primary. So in case of multiple primary nodes and no standby nodes in the cluster, PgPool 2 will remove all the primary nodes, because it doesn't make sense. Like there are primary nodes, but there are no standby nodes attached to them. And in case of multiple primary and multiple standby nodes, PgPool 2 will find the primary node with which the standby nodes are connected. And you, for doing that, you use the PgStat wall receiver view to try to figure out which primary node actually has the standby nodes connected with it, and then remove the other one. the check for the detached false primaries performed every SR check period. SR is for streaming replication check period. So we piggyback this check along with checking the replication delay. So if you disable that, then you'll effectively also disable detached false primary detection. So this is the flow chart, like what when the false primary will get detached. So if you see, if you have in the bottom left corner, like we have two primary nodes, primary one and primary two, while primary one is have two standby nodes, while primary two doesn't have one. This is easy thing. Then PgPool II will remove the primary two from the system and detaches it. But if you have only two standbys and no primary, then PgPool has nothing to do. And if you have one primary, then everything is good. But if you have one primary connected to one standby and the other primary connected to another standby, like they are two identical primary standby system, then this is the case, like PgPool can decide which one is the good primary and which one is the bad or the evil one. So it just gives the warning message and do nothing. Like it, and you have to do it manually. Okay, so next is the other related configuration parameter which affects the automatic failover. So auto failback, again, this is new thing in the PgPool II. We don't have it in the older versions. And what it does is like it enables automatic reattaching of the failed standby nodes. For example, as we discussed, like in case of a standby node failure, the problematic standby node is silently removed from the cluster without disrupting the system, because we have a primary already working and other standbys already working. So in this case, it only works in the streaming replication mode, and it is very helpful for the lousy networks where the standby node gets detached because of some network glitch. And how PgPool II detects if the standby node is healthy, it uses the PgStat replication on primary node to see it, verify if the detached standby node is healthy and streaming replication is working on it. And if PgPool finds out like the streaming replication is perfectly working on it, and somehow it is the standby was detached from our system, then it just go on and reattach the standby again. Again, the check is performed on SR underscore check period, and if you disable a streaming replication check, then this functionality will not be available. So SR check, like it checks the delay, the streaming replication delay, it performs auto failback, and it performs the detached false primary. So it is very, very like it is the same thing is used for three main purposes. And auto failback interval, you can definitely configure the interval in seconds between execution of auto failback. Like for example, you have a very lousy network and your standby node is coming and going every other second. So, and you don't want to do that because you don't want to keep attaching the standby nodes. So you can configure the auto failback interval, like if a failback has happened, the next auto failback won't execute until the specified amount of time has passed after the previous failback. This is helpful in preventing the frequent failover than failback in case of unstable networks. I don't think so. We still have such kind of unstable networks, but yeah, you can configure this particular parameter if you want to. Then there is a search primary node timeout. Like it's configured the maximum amount of time in second to search for the primary node. Whenever you search the configure the PgPool II in streaming replication mode, whenever the PgPool starts, first thing it do is it look out for the primary node, and then if it can't find the primary, it keep looking for it. And this search primary node timeout variable like sets the timeout, like after how many seconds you just give up and looking for the primary and just go on and without primary you can't do much with the PgPool II, like because your write statements won't work. But still, yeah. And at the time this search primary node timeout kicks in is after the failover. whenever a failover happened, for example, your original primary node failed, and then the failover is performed, then after performing the failover, PgPool will again look for the primary node, and again this timeout setting will kicks in if it is not able to find the primary node within this particular amount of time, then it will give up looking for the primary node. So yeah, this is an important configuration parameter. After that, we have failover command, follow master command, and failback commands. These are the three commands. These are basically the workhorse of the whole failover system. The first one, failover command, it configures the command to run when the Postgres backend node goes down or it gets detached. And the second one is the follow master command that configures the user command to run after the failover on primary node in case of a primary node failover. So this is where we reconfigure the our standby nodes to point to the new primary node. And the last one is the failback command. This is the command which gets run when if a new standby node gets attached to the PgPool II cluster. We'll discuss each one. So this is just a description of failover command. It configures the user command to run when Postgres backend node gets detached, and you can pass the following backend like all the below mentioned parameters to that command, like %d, %h, %p, and these are just information you want in the failover script to do particular calculations. And similarly, okay, so this is how the failover works. This is the mechanism of the failover. So the first thing PgPool 2 does whenever the failover process starts is it kills all the child process. This means terminate all the active user sessions. This only happens in case of a primary node failure. In case of a failover process started because of a standby node failure, it will not kill all the child processes. So we're discussing about the primary node failure. If the primary node goes down, the first thing PgPool failover does is it will terminate all the active user sessions. Then it will invoke the user provided script configured in failover command. This is the script we have configured in this failover command. And then on the second step, it will execute the failover command. And then this is the responsibility of the user provided command to promote one of the standby to the new primary in case of a primary node failover. And once that is done, the failover command script gets executed. The next thing failover does is it executes the follow master command. I think we'll discuss that later. So once the failover command is finished, PgPool 2 will respawn the child process and start accepting the new connections. And as I told you, since version 3.6, in case of a standby node failure, PgPool will only kill those sessions that were actively using the failed node. Others user session remains uninterrupted. Before 3.6, we used to blindly kill all the child process whenever a failover kicks in, and so that was not a good thing. Like even in case of a standby, we used to have a disruption. And like every session needs to reconnect with PgPool 2. So we have improved this particular thing in 3.6. So what we do in failover as such. So normally this is the normal. You can change it. We have quite a lot of information present in the failover.sh. We can deploy some other mechanism to look for the primary or for anything, but in the normal working, what we do is we pass the master node ID as argument that can be passed using the %m to the failover script, and then that master node ID this master node ID is a little different from the primary node ID. Primary node is the one that is the streaming replication primary node. it can be backend 0, backend 1, backend 2, backend 3. It doesn't matter. Basically, the primary node, when we refer to the primary node, it is the node that is the master or the primary node which is serving the other standby nodes on the Postgres side. But when we talk about master node ID, it is the smallest node amongst the live nodes. For example, suppose we have a 3 node cluster. Node 0 is a primary node, and somehow it fails. So PgPool 2 will set the next the master node ID to the 1 is equal to 1, provided node 1 is alive. And if the node 1 is also down, then it will set to the next node ID, which is 2. But if all the nodes are down, then master node ID is set to -1. So the whole purpose of the master node ID thing is, like, it gives the ID number of the node, the smallest ID number of the node that is alive in the system. Set, if the master node ID comes out to be -1, this means that there is no alive Postgres node currently available for PgPool 2 to work on. So this is just the smallest node ID. And what we do normally is we promote the smallest node ID to the become a new primary. Of course, we can have different we can deploy different mechanisms or some other way to identify which node should become a new primary. But currently, what we do in the failover.sh is we just promotes the standby node that is pointed by the master node ID to become a new primary, which might not be a very good thing, but this is the simplest thing to do. But yeah, you can do anything in the failover.sh. Like, it's open. So what we do is, like, we quickly bail out if the passed in master node ID is less than 0. That means there's no live node. We have nothing much to do in the failover.sh. So just exit the script. But if the master node ID is some valid number, next we check if the failed node was a primary node or a standby node. And we can easily do that by comparing the failed node ID that is passed into the failover script with the old primary node ID. If the both node failed node ID and the old primary node ID are same, this means the failed node was the primary node, and we need to promote one of the standbys to become a new primary node because the old primary is gone. So for that, if we identified that the failed node was a primary node, first thing we do is we drop the replication slot and from the primary node, and we can do that as a slack pg drop replication slot. And if the failed node was in case of the standby node failure, we just drop the replication slot from the primary because we know that standby is not available. But in case of the primary node failure, we use pg_ctl -w with promote to promote the standby node to the new primary. So this is all we need to do in the either promote and standby to the new to become a new primary node, or in case of a standby node failure, just drop the associated replication slot from the master node. These are the two things the failover.sh needs to do. So yeah, this is I've just pasted the basic example of the failover.sh. If you see in the start, we just log, like, if the master node ID is less than 0, this means all nodes are down. So skipping the failover. Next thing we do is we try to look at if the failed node was a primary node or was a standby node. And in case of a standby node failure, we are just dropping the replication slot by calling select pg_drop replication slot. And otherwise, we are promoting the new we are promoting the node pointed by new master node ID to become a new primary node. So once the failover is done, we'll have either a new primary node or we'll have a standby node, that failed standby node, removed from the cluster. So next thing is the follow master command. So just in case when the primary node goes down, what we did in the failover.sh was we promoted one of the standby to become a new primary. Now there's another thing which needs to be done, and that is we need to we need to do like if for example we if we have three nodes cluster and one primary and two standby nodes, and somehow the primary node goes down. Now what we did in the failover.sh was we promoted standby one to become a new primary. Now there is one more step needs to be done. That is, we need to reconfigure the standby two so that its primary it should point to then our new primary node, and it should not keep waiting for the data from the old primary which already is failed. So this step is done in the follow master command, and again just like failover.sh, you can pass plenty of information in the follow master.script with these options like %d %d %d. So, I've just written everything like what this particular parameter mean, and you just look up in the PgPool documentation to see if you want to pass particular information, then which parameter you can use. So what we do in failover.sh as follow master command is used to recover the slave from the new primary, as I just told you. So the recommended practice is to first check if the standby node is running or not. So we can do it by using pgctl -w -f. So just to make sure if somehow we had a network problem and the failover is caused by some other issue, then we must stop the old primary node. So that's first thing we do. Then we create a new replication slot in the new primary, and that is again we use the pg create physical replication slot. And the next thing is a bit trickier part. Now we have to make sure that the standby node should be connected to the new primary node, and we can use pg underscore rewind utility for doing that. And if somehow the other pg rewind fails, then what we normally do is we delete the old data directory, and we use the pg base backup to take a new backup from take the backup from the new primary node, and then we attach that particular backup as a standby to the newly promoted primary node. So these are the steps like we normally do in the follow master.sh. So examples of the follow master and failover.sh, you can find these examples on the PgPool II sites. I've just pasted the link for that, and these scripts are also part of the Docker environment. I've made them a little modifications from the original scripts which are present on the website, and did some enhancements. So you can also try the scripts which are part of the Docker setups hosted on the GitHub account. So the next thing is let's configure the failover in PgPool 2 step by step. So because the failover is a very core component of the PgPool, so I want to emphasize on like what we need to do. So the first thing is we need to edit the failover.sh script and like create a new script if we want to, because by default it's not present there. So we just go on and paste the sample failover.sh, and we can download it from the pgpool2.net official site, and just paste it there, and then edit the follow master.sh script or create one, and then again paste the example from the same site for the follow master.sh, and set the execution permission for both of the scripts, and you can just do it using chmod +x, and that's it. And then next thing is we need to put the path in the for these two scripts in the pgpool.conf file, and for that we just set the follow master failover underscore command, and for now we are just passing in every possible argument in the script. And like if you can see /etc pgpool to failover.sh, then %d %h %h. For now we are just passing it each and every argument that can be passed in the script, although we might not be using every single one of them, but it's good to have it configured this way. And similarly we'll do the same for the follow master command, and we'll just point the follow master command configuration parameter to point to the follow master script, and we'll just pass in every possible argument in that one. And yeah, we are ready to go. So once we have done that, you can see in the video, like, let's try it out. Like, if the failover is working, first just connect to the PgPool 2 and do show pool underscore nodes and see if we are connected to three nodes. Next, we'll just go on and stop the master node. So for that, we'll log into the Docker that is hosting our master Postgres node, and we'll just do the service stop. So service Postgres then stop, and this will stop the service. So hopefully the health check of the PgPool 2 kicks in and it detects the primary node is not available at the moment. So it will do perform the failover, and it should pick up another node to become a new standby node to become a primary node. So let's look into the logs. Like, we can see the child process with PID exited with successful, and worker process and fork a new child process. So this is the kind of log that appears when the failover happens. Like, it disconnects all the child. So you see, like, PG slave, the failover has picked up the node number node number one, that was PG slave, and made it a new primary node. So yeah, this is how the failover works. Like, whenever the problem or the primary node goes down, the next node, the failover picks up the next node and make it the new master. So that was it for the failover and the configuration. And the next thing is watchdog. And let's see what is watchdog. So if what we have done so far, if you consider that, like, what we have done is, like, we have installed multiple multiple Postgres nodes on front of PgPool 2, and effectively not only we distributed the load amongst the primary and the standby, we also achieved a high availability, kind of a high availability. Like, if our primary node goes down, then one of the standby becomes a new primary node, and effectively we have a very, very minimal disruption in the system. Like, normally the failover process takes around a couple of seconds, or maybe 4 or 5 seconds, depend upon the data. And so even in case of primary node failure, all you have is a few seconds of disruption in the system, and then everything starts working again, like nothing has happened. So this is the automatic failover mechanism has provided us the high availability on the database sides. So database side. And but if you consider the whole cluster, we need to consider, like, what will happen if our PgPool itself goes down. Because if you see, we have three Postgres nodes. If one fails, another one will take over. But we have only single PgPool node, and if that node goes down, our service will stop working. So effectively, PgPool 2 is a single point of failure in the whole setup. And now we want to solve this one. We want to resolve this single point of failure. So how we do that? Basically, for doing that, we install multiple PgPool 2 nodes. Like in the example, in this case, we instead of single PgPool 2 node, we use two PgPool nodes, and we can use more than two, but for this example, we are using two nodes, and these two nodes are connected through the watchdog. Watchdog is a built-in feature of the PgPool 2. We'll discuss it in detail. But then instead of using the hardcore IP or the IP address of the PgPool 2 node, we use a virtual IP address. And we use the virtual IP to connect to the PgPool 2 node. So we'll discuss the virtual IP in detail. Yeah. So yeah. Okay. So now let's see, like, what happened if the primary PgPool node goes down, it becomes available. The second PgPool 2 or the other PgPool nodes in the system will detect that failure, and they will acquire the virtual IP onto themselves. So the clients will see no difference. Like client was using the same virtual IP to connect to the PgPool to one PgPool node one, and now once that node fails, the same virtual IP is now acquired by the other PgPool node, and the clients will see no difference. The service will keep working. Only the current session will get disconnected, and this whole process will take less than a second, and you'll see no disruption. So this is all done by the watchdog process of the PgPool 2. So what is the watchdog? Watchdog is a sub process of PgPool 2 to handle the failures of PgPool 2 node. So what it does is it does the life checking of other of the PgPool services, and all the PgPool nodes in the cluster. We call it the cluster where we have multiple PgPool 2 nodes. So they do a mutual monitoring of each other and to detect the failure. And they at the startup or in case of a failure, they do a leader election to select the master primary node. So the watchdog use the bullying algorithm to select the new active or new master node. So they do the election, leader election, and there are plenty of parameters they consider during the election, like which node should be considered the best possible candidate to become a new leader. And this is done by watchdog. Another thing watchdog do is virtual IP control. Virtual IP control is the one like where we switch the virtual IP from like this first system to the second one. This is the virtual IP control mechanism of the watchdog. And it also ensures the same view of Postgres backend on across all the nodes. Because we don't want, like for example, if the PgPool 1 was working and it has its own view of Postgres node. For example, in this case, it has Postgres node 1 as a primary and other 2 as a standby. So what we don't want it like when the virtual IP is shifted to the other one, it should not have a different view of the system. Like it should also have these same 3 nodes with the same 3 settings with the same health checking mechanism, so that the clients connecting to the PgPool 2 to the Postgres through the PgPool 2 should not feel or see any difference. So any intermediate setting changes that happens between the failure and before the start, after the start of the service, they should get replicated on all the other nodes. So this is again the responsibility of the watchdog module, that it should make sure that all the PgPool in the cluster should see the same backend view. And finally, the distributed failover management. Whenever a failover happens, like all the nodes should coordinate with each other about the failure of the node, and then all the nodes should coordinate to make sure they all select the exact same node as a new primary. We don't want that if the failover happens, like the PgPool 1 selects node ID 1 as a new primary while another PgPool 2 node selects some other node, maybe node number 2 as a primary. So that will cause a split brain on the database side, on the server side. So we don't want that. So this is the responsibility of the watchdog module to coordinate and do a failover in such a way like every node agrees on a same failover and perform a same steps. So the distributed, we call it distributed failover management, and this is also responsibility of the watchdog. So if you look at the watchdog and what are the logical components, so one thing watchdog does is the life checking. The life checking module of the watchdog is responsible for monitoring the health check of other PgPool 2 nodes in the watchdog cluster. So we can do that life checking using 2 methods. One is query and one is heartbeat. In the query mode, basically what watchdog does is like it sends the SQL query, which is normally select one. That's it, the smallest query possible to the PgPool 2 which it needs to monitor. And if the query was successful, and then it says that the node is healthy, otherwise it marks in case of failure, it marks the node that's down. So this is a query-based health checking, and other is heartbeat. And heartbeat is a more advanced way. Like it has its own channel. It uses the UDP sockets and sends a periodic heartbeat signal over the UDP sockets, and again receives the same from the other node. And whenever the heartbeat misses. And you can configure the heartbeat, like how many the interval between the heartbeat and everything, and it can detect failure by the missing heartbeat from a particular node. So yeah, so using the heartbeat is a better way for the health checking, because the query mode consumes one additional backend connection and one additional PgPool child process which will be used to process that particular query. So it's not recommended. The better way is to use heartbeat, but of course you can use query if you don't want UDP packets to be flowing on your system. So another thing live checking does is it can check the upstream connectivity and by pinging some known server. For example, your service is like we are making some service which is available on the internet, and so even though our local network would be working fine, but we don't want like it gets disconnected from the internet. So what we can do is we can set up the upstream server, or we can configure the upstream server connectivity by configuring a ping to some known server. For example, google.com, like we can configure ping google.com after every 10 seconds, and if the ping result is successful, then keep continuing the service, otherwise disconnects. Like we can have similar kind of requirement, especially in the case when there's if the cluster consists of multiple availability zones. For example, if we are running the cluster on Amazon, and one PgPool is on West Coast, another one is on the East Coast. So sometimes we want to use the upstream connectivity check just to make sure the overall data center is not isolated at the moment. So the next thing is leader election module. That is again in the part of the watchdog, and it is responsible for selecting the best candidate to become active master PgPool 2 node. And this happened, the leader elections happens at the startup time, and also whenever the existing primary node or the active PgPool 2 node fails. So it ensures the existence of the quorum, and it guards against the split brain syndrome. So the quorum I'll try to explain the quorum thing in the coming slides, I guess. The other thing is delegate IP controller, and this is the one which is responsible for acquiring and releasing the virtual IP from the PgPool 2 node, depend upon the current watchdog status of the node. For example, if the watchdog node was primary and for some reason it has to resign from its primary node status, then this IP delegate IP controller will release the IP from the system, and then whichever node becomes the new master or new active PgPool 2 node, the delegate IP controller on that PgPool 2 will acquire the IP. And this is from look of it, it looks a very simple thing, but we need to make sure that we don't have a same IP address acquired by multiple system at any time, because this will cause this will make the network go haywire. So yeah, this delegate IP controller module makes sure we release and acquire virtual IP and effectively. And the last thing is that the distributed failover management. This is what I've already explained. Like this, what it does is it synchronizes the backend node status among all the participating nodes and coordinate the consensus for the backend node failure. Whenever if you have three PgPool nodes in a watchdog cluster, and only one of the node sees the failure of a particular backend Postgres node, then instead of doing a failover, even when its health check mechanism is informing the PgPool 2 that this node is not reachable, So in the watchdog mode, you can configure the PgPool to like whenever you see the failure, even whenever you detect the failure, you just don't do the failover by yourself. You must coordinate with other nodes, and if all the nodes or if the majority of the nodes agree about that failure, only then perform the failover. And otherwise, just make the node quarantine, and we'll discuss the quarantine nodes. So this is the concept of the watchdog. We install multiple PgPool 2 nodes. As a best practice, it is recommended to use odd number of total nodes and minimum 3 nodes, and make all nodes aware of each other. Like we configure a watchdog nodes for in pgpool.conf, we configure all the watchdog nodes. Like if the clusters had 3 nodes, then we need to set the settings of all the other nodes in each pgpool.conf file. We'll do that in just a little bit. Then the active master node acquires the delegate virtual IP address. All the client uses that virtual IP to connect to the pgpool service. And all PgPool 2 nodes part of the watchdog cluster keep health checking the node. And as soon as the failure of active master node is detected by the cluster, the whole cluster goes into the election mode. And then the cluster selects a new master active PgPool 2 node. And the new active node acquires the virtual IP. And as I told you, the client applications keep on connecting to the same IP address and hardly notice a problem. So let's do a step-by-step or a walkthrough of configuring a PgPool 2 cluster with watchdog. So we'll create 3 node watchdog cluster. For that, we'll use 3 host: server 1 host, server 2 host, server 3 host. And we have given pgpool_server1, pgpool_server2, and similarly pgpool_server3 to the respective hosts. These are the host names. So first thing we need to do is we need to enable the watchdog on all the servers. These are the settings we need to do on each separate node. So normally what we do is we create a pgpool.conf file, we do the settings, and then we replicate that particular configuration file on all the nodes we want to create a cluster of. So these are the settings we need to do on all the thing, and these are settings that will stay same on all the nodes. So first thing is use_watchdog is equal to on. This will enable the watchdog. And the second thing is set virtual IP on all 3 servers. And for virtual IP, the configuration parameter name is delegate_IP. And we can use whatever IP address we want. For this example, I'm using 172.22.0.99. So this is the IP address which the client application will use to connect to the service. So put in the same delegate IP address on all the nodes. And then we have to configure 3 commands: if up command, if down command, and rpin command. These are just 3 commands that are required to bring up and bring down the virtual IP. So normally in the Linux, we use IP adder add and IP adder del commands to assign the virtual IP. And depending upon the system configuration, then you need to specify the label or the device on which you want to bring on the virtual IP. So you need, normally these configurations stay same for all the systems, but you can use a different if up and if down commands if required. And the rpin command is just used after bringing up or bringing down the virtual IP, just to announce, like if announced in the network, like I have acquired the IP or I have released the IP, so that every node have the latest ARP table updated after that. Okay, so the next thing is if command path and rpin command path. These needs to be set by default. They are set to the right location in the pgpool.conf. But if your flavor of the Linux, or if for some security reason, like you have placed these binaries in some different directory, then you can specify these commands command path using this configuration parameter. And then you need to set the WD port. This is 9000 is the default watchdog port, and you can can change it to any value you want, but you need to make sure like the WD port of a particular system should be configured properly on each system. So this is what you need to do on all settings. Up till now, up to this WD port needs to be same on all the nodes on the watchdog. Either it's 3-node cluster, 4, 5. So the setting needs to be same on all the nodes. Next, we'll do the settings which are different on each node. So first, let's configure our PgPool _server1. So we'll set the WD host name to PgPool _server1. This is the host name of the machine that PgPool 2 will be working on. For this particular PgPool 2 node will be running, and then after that we need to set the IP addresses or host names of other two nodes. Remember, we are using 3-node cluster, so we need to set the other PgPool host name 0 and other PgPool host name 1. And similarly, heartbeat destination, because we are using the heartbeat mechanism for the health checking. So we are also setting heartbeat destination 0, and we set the server name of other two servers in 0 and 1. So for 0, we are setting PgPool server 2, and for host name 1, we are setting PgPool server 3. Similarly, for server 2, we'll set the host name as PgPool server 2, and now for host name 0 we are setting host server 1 as host name 0 and server 3. So this is just a configuration, like each server have the needs the configuration of other two servers. So for the self, we'll use the WD host name. For example, for PgPool server 3, we'll use WD hostname as PgPool server 3 because it is running on the PgPool _server3 host, and then we need to do the setting for server 1 and server 2, and we'll use the other PgPool hostname 0 and other PgPool hostname 1 for that. I guess I hope you guys understand, like, so basically I've created a Docker environment with the exact configuration, and you can also download and have a look in the configuration from and download that from the GitHub site. So these are few key concepts of the watchdog system. Existence of the quorum, like we can say the quorum exists in the watchdog cluster if the number of live watchdog node, that is number of PgPool 2 nodes in the, is greater than the total number of configured nodes. For example, if the total configured node watchdog nodes are 5, then for the existence of quorum, we must have at least minimum three alive nodes, 3 or more alive nodes. And in case of the 3-node cluster we have just created, we must need at least 2 alive nodes, then only then our quorum is complete. And for even number of nodes, though it is not recommended, but if somehow or the other you want to use the even number of watchdog nodes, we regard the quorum exists when the half of the nodes are alive. For example, if you deploy only 2-node cluster, then even if the one node is alive, that means the quorum exists in the system. For the 4-node cluster, minimum 2 nodes would be required, but using an even number of watchdog nodes will be prone to split brain syndrome, so it is not recommended. The next thing is quarantine backend nodes. So the quarantine backend nodes are same as detached nodes, except that when the node goes into the quarantine state, there is no degeneration performed on it. For example, in case of a failed standby node, the failover mechanism kicks in. But in case of when the node goes into the quarantine state, there is no failover mechanism is performed. And unlike on the failed nodes, PgPool 2 continues the health check on quarantine nodes, and as soon as the quarantine node becomes reachable again, PgPool 2 will silently add back the node to the like remove the node from the quarantine state and make it alive and healthy. So another important part is like if a primary database node goes into the quarantine state on the active or a master watchdog node, then that master watchdog node resigns from being a master or from being an active watchdog and let some other PgPool to become a new master, because master node or a primary node is a really important for the continuation of the service. Without primary node, you cannot serve the write statements. So as soon as the primary watchdog node, the master watchdog node, that is the one that has the virtual IP acquired, it sees like the primary node on its PgPool 2 becomes quarantine, is just resigns from being a master and let some other one, and in that particular election, which happens because of its resignation, it tries downvotes itself so that it should not become the master again and let some other node becomes a master. So yeah, this is very important thing to note. And how the node goes into the quarantine? Well, it's simple. Like, for example, if you have a consensus enabled for the watchdog, for the backend node failure, and somehow or the other, one of the node thinks that the backend node is not reachable, but that backend node is reachable by all other PgPool 2 nodes. So what happens is the PgPool 2 node which particular Postgres node is marked as failed, it asks other nodes just to build a consensus on the failure. And if all other nodes vote against that consensus, or minimum, like it does not get enough vote for the failure, then it marks that node as quarantine because this node is not reachable from this node, but other PgPool 2 are not agreeing on the failure. So that node is temporarily marked as quarantine and until it becomes healthy or reachable again. So yeah, this is a bit a little twisty to explain, but this is how the quarantine the node gets into the quarantine, and whenever the primary node gets quarantine on the active watchdog node, that watchdog node resigns from being active node or a master node. So next thing is like how we can secure the watchdog communication. WD_auth key parameter like configures the authentication key which can be used for all the watchdog related communications. And yeah, because you don't want any client just to send a signal on the watchdog and make the watchdog something has happened. Like, for example, without WD_auth key, I can create a client which sends replicates exact packet which a node sends in case of a backend node failure. So to guard against such kind of intrusions or problems, like you can configure WD_auth key, and then all the communications, watchdog communication will use that key and will encrypt the message using that WD_auth key, and then if some message arrives which is not encrypted and WD_auth key is configured or encrypted with the wrong key, then that message will be rejected by the watchdog. So effectively, this WD_auth key should be same on all the nodes, and also the packets the heartbeat packets, they also use the same WD_auth key if configured, and they are also encrypted using the same key. So this is simple. It's just a key that is used for encrypting the watchdog communication. Okay, so upstream server connections. So as I told you, you can configure trusted servers and you can assign a comma separated list of servers to check upstream connectivity. PgPool 2 will send a periodic ping to each of the server in the list, and if none of the server from the list respond back, then PgPool 2 will consider itself as isolated from the network, even and commits a suicide, and this means the PgPool node will shut down itself. So this is for a particular kind of a workload where, as I told you, like where we need to have some configuration where our PgPool 2 nodes are installed on different availability zones, and we need to make sure like the whole availability zone or the whole data center is connected from the external world. In that kind of scenario, we use trusted servers configuration. And ping path, this is the ping utility path, which is used by trusted server configuration to do the ping. Like by default, the ping you can change if you want to have a different location for the ping path. You can use this configuration to change there. Okay, behavior on escalation and de-escalation. So before discussing the behavior, like escalation is the process when a PgPool 2 watchdog node become master coordinator active, whatever we want to call it. So whenever a PgPool 2 nodes become master node or active node, this process is called escalation. And whenever the master node resigns from being a master, then this process is called de-escalation in terms of PgPool 2. So we can configure what should happen in case when the escalation and de-escalation happen. So the first thing is clear memcache on escalation. So you can configure caching on PgPool 2, like PgPool can cache the read queries and then serve when the same query comes in and from its own cache without going to the backend. So we can configure if in case of escalation and de-escalation, if you want to clear the memcache. So this is a Boolean parameter, we can do that. Then WD escalation command and WD de-escalation commands. These are optional scripts which we can provide. For example, WD escalation command, if you provide a script in WD escalation command, then this script will be executed before bringing up the virtual IP from the active node. And this is very important, like you can send in the email from there if you want, because if you want to notify the admin like the something has happened because now new watchdog node is becoming active. This means the previous one has gone down. So you can configure to send IP emails to the administrator. Or another thing, like for example, if you're using some cloud environment, for example, Amazon cloud, and you don't want there is no like virtual IP kind of system exists there, and they have their own mechanism like Elastic IP, and instead of virtual IP you want to use Elastic IP as a floating IP which should get transferred from one system to another, and all the clients use you give that Elastic IP to all the clients so that they can use to connect that IP, they can use that IP to connect to the service. So what you can do is you can script that acquiring and releasing of Elastic IP using these WD escalation command and WD de-escalation command scripts. In that case, what you'll do is you'll leave the virtual IP as empty, and instead you'll write two scripts for escalation and de-escalation. And in the escalation script, you'll call the Amazon's web service, whatever they gave you, like for acquiring a new for acquiring a particular Elastic IP, and you'll execute that system command or that API. And in WD de-escalation, you'll use another API which your cloud provider may provide for releasing that virtual IP. So these two escalation, although these are not mandatory, and everything works fine if you are using the delegate IP, but you can do lots of things using these two optional scripts, and you can call it hooks or whatever. So these are the two things. So the escalation command, it executed before bringing up the virtual IP, and similarly the de-escalation command, this command is executed before bringing down the virtual IP. So yeah, you can use it for plenty of purposes. Okay, the next thing is backend failover consensus. I've touched this topic a little bit previously. So as you know, failover is a very expensive procedure, and it can cause a loss of running transaction, and it can make the current session disconnect for some time, and then it is really, really, really very important to make sure that we only do failover when it's absolutely necessary. So for that purpose, PgPool 2 node part of the watchdog cluster, like if you have configured the PgPool 2 in the watchdog, then the PgPool 2 can nodes can coordinate with each other to vet the backend node failure before proceeding to the generation or failover. So this is very helpful to guard against false alarms and temporary network glitches. And so you effectively this can save lots of valuable data and valuable time. Again, this is kind of a new feature in PgPool 2, and I think 4. It was first introduced in 4.0, and I've authored this. And before that, I used to get so many complaints from on the community, like there was small network glitch, or there was a small CPU glitch, and that caused the failover. So after adding this backend failover consensus functionality, like literally there's no more similar complaints. Like because now you have a way to guard against such network glitches. So PgPool provides few parameters for controlling the failover behavior, and these are failover when quorum exists. This is the one, like only do the failover when the quorum is present in the cluster. For example, if you have configured the Postgres the watchdog with three nodes, then and at that particular time there is only one node alive in the one watchdog was alive, then no matter what happens, then if you set the failover when quorum exists to on, then failover will not happen, and the node will only go the failed node will go to the quarantine state, but the system will wait for the quorum, and whenever the quorum become available again, only then the failover can be performed. So the second thing is failover requires consensus. So when enabled, PgPool 2 will only perform failover degeneration when the watchdog, the first thing is the watchdog cluster holds a quorum, and the second thing is after getting the minimum vote equivalent to the number of nodes required for the quorum. For example, for the 5-node cluster, if we get minimum 3 votes in favor of failover, only then we will perform the failover. For example, if we have 5-node cluster and 2 nodes say yeah, we can see the failure of the node, and other three nodes says like no, we are happy with how things are, and we are able to reach the node the particular backend, then the failover will not be performed. The problematic node will get quarantined on 2 of those nodes which were on the favor of the failover, and the rest of the 3 nodes will see no difference. And if it was a primary node and the quarantine node was the primary node, and it was the failure was seen from the active PgPool 2 node, then that node will resign from the master node, and one of the node which sees that everything is working fine will become a new master. So this make thing the whole thing very smooth and very good. So the last parameter which controls it is allow multiple failover requests from a node. Again, if for some reason or other you want, like if a particular node sees the failure multiple times, then it can cast multiple vote for the failure. Without this particular parameter enabled, then we need in a 5-node cluster, we need three votes in favor of failover from three different nodes to proceed for failover. But if you set allow multiple failover requests from node, then you would if the quorum is present and you get three votes in favor of failover even from the same node, then the failover will be performed. So you might not be using this particular configuration very often, but this is for some scenarios where you want to make sure, like if a node is continuously not responsive on something on some particular PgPool, you want to bring down that node and repair it or do some manual action, so it can be used there. But this is not a normal configuration parameter which you set it to on every other installation. Okay, so enable consensus with half words. So basically this sets the algorithm for computation of majority rule. Majority rule is used for quorum and consensus calculation, but when enabled, a single node can cast multiple. This is what we have. So what happens is if you have even number of nodes, so this enable consensus with half words, if set to on, this means then only when we get votes that would mean only 50% of nodes are enough for completing the quorum or for deciding the majority. But if you set this to off, then this means the half plus one votes are required. This only happens, like this only become effective when we have even number of nodes. But again, it is not recommended to use even number of node, and so it's better. Like the recommended way is to use odd number of nodes, and because then we can decide the clear majority every time. So this is where I list all the things like best practices we need to follow. The first one is we use odd number of PgPool 2 nodes, minimum 3, and the other thing is enable failover consensus with backend health checking. Yeah, and this is very important. Like the failover consensus does not work properly if the backend health check is not enabled on one of the node or on all the nodes, because if you disable the health checking, then it is possible then that the even in case of failure, the failure is not detected by one of the node, and it will not cast the vote in favor or in favor of the failover, and eventually the genuine failure will get unnoticed. So whenever you set the failover on consensus to on, always use backend health checking. And another important point is always set the similar configuration for health checking on all PgPool 2 nodes. So we don't want that, like if one node is using 10 seconds between health check retries and another is using 100 seconds, then again the consensus will not work because the consensus mechanism automatically fails after waiting for some time. Like if it doesn't get the like no vote is if some node doesn't give a vote, that means that is a negative vote. So the whole algorithm expects like every node uses a similar amount of time between the health check interval. So this is another important point. Like we always use the similar configurations for health checking. And then WD priority, like priority sets the node priority and make it more likely to become a active or a master or a coordinator watchdog node. So we can manipulate this WD priority on different nodes to make sure like which node should become a master, and in case of that the current master failure, which node should be more likely to become a next master. So you can use this WD priority parameter to make sure higher value of WD priority doesn't give 100% guarantee that the node with the highest priority will get selected as a master, because the algorithm which selects the master node, it also takes care of so many other things like number of coordinate nodes, number of active connections, number of failed attempts. But WD priority, a higher WD priority gives a better chance of winning an election for the master node. So you can change this parameter as per your liking. You can set the priority of the systems, which one should become the master first, or in case of the failure, which one should follow. Similarly, I don't recommend using upstream connectivity unless it is absolutely necessary. I've seen so many people complaining like their PgPool II node shuts down itself because they use the wrong upstream connectivity settings. So it is like everything works fine without upstream connectivity unless we have a scenario where, as we discussed, where we want to make sure the whole data center or whole availability zone is always connected to another availability zone. Other than that, never use upstream connectivity. It causes more problems than it solves. So yeah, in normal circumstances. So this is kind of a best practice for using the watchdog. This is a typical deployment of a watchdog system. We have application servers which uses virtual IP to connect to the watchdog to the PgPool II. And in this, all the PgPool II connect, PgPool II's watchdog processes, they connect to each other and do information sharing and mutual monitoring. And then all the PgPool II part of the cluster connects to the same backends using the unique IP of the or the host name of the backend servers. So this is just a simple visual representation of the typical system, typical deployment. Okay, I think I have to speed up things because we are running out of time. So next is the PCP interface. So what is PCP? PCP is that administrative interface of PgPool II for performing various management tasks. PCP stands for PgPool Control Protocol. And for that, PgPool II exposes a socket interface, and you can monitor and perform various tasks using on that interface. So for configuring the PCP, you need a pcp.conf file, and by default, PgPool expects that pcp.conf file present in the same directory where the other configuration files are present, like pgpool.conf. And you can override that configuration config file path using minus capital F in the startup in the command line option. And the PCP conf, although from the name it seems like it is a configuration file, but actually it has only username and password for the PCP connections. You can set username colon md5 encrypted password in the pcp.conf file, and this has nothing to do with the database username and password, and these user doesn't need to be present in Postgres backend server. This particular username and password is only used for PCP connections, and you can use the MD5 utility, which is already present, which comes with the PgPool II, to create MD5 password, and you just copy paste that the password it gives in the pcp.conf file against the username, and you can use that username and password to connect to the PCP. So this is how we can configure the PCP. Just use pgmd5 and my password or whatever password you want to require, and it will give you the MD5 hash for that particular password. Then just copy that password and open the /etc/pcp.conf file and paste that password in front of the username after the colon. For example, in this case, I'm using pcp_user as a username and then my password as the password, and so I pasted the my password's md5 hash in front of the PCP username, and yeah, we are good to go. So this is what we need. Other configuration we need to do for that. For example, PCP listen address, we can set it all, and we can set it like empty string if we want to only allow Unix domain connections on PCP. And this is, by the way, the recommended way. Like we normally don't want to expose the PCP interface to the external world. So the normal way is to only allow Unix domain connections on the PCP interface. But of course, you can use TCP and all other connections interface. Then there is a PCP port, and this PCP socket directory port is a port number, which is a TCP port number. Or in case of a Unix sockets, Unix port number, and the PCP socket directory is for the socket directory directory where the Unix socket file will be placed. So you can configure any socket any directory where, and then you need to provide the same directory to the PCP utility to connect to the PgPool 2 using the PCP interface. So these are just trivial things, and so once we have done these configuration, you can just try PCP node info command to make sure that if everything is working fine. So here I've used PCP_node_info -u PCP user. That is the username I've put in the PCP.conf file, and zero. This means give me the node information of node number, backend node number, node number zero. So if the utility will print out all the information for that particular node, and in case of any problem, it will give the or emit the error. So you can just try executing the PCP command to verify if the PCP is set properly in the PgPool configuration. So another thing is PCP password file. And I think you guys, most of you are already familiar with using the PSQL pass files. Like you can use a .pg PSQL pass file placed in the home directory, and then PSQL uses that file for passwordless connections to the database. So these kind of things are very important if you want to script something. So so PCP interface also exposes that same thing. Like you can create a .pcp pass file in a user's home directory, or if you want to place it on some other location, you can export the PCP pass file environment variable, and you can specify the PCP pass file path there. So if you create that pass file, then PCP utilities will use that password file to get the password for a particular user, and then they will not prompt for the password. This is very useful for scripting the PCP commands. And similar to the PSQL pass file, the PCP pass file format is same: host name colon port colon username colon password. So you can use star in first three fields, like star colon star then password. This means for any host name, for any port, for any username, use this particular password, and like you can use it to specify the password for specified user for a specified host name as well. And permission, they should be 0600, must disallow any access to the world, otherwise the utilities will not recognize the PCP pass file and ignore that. So yeah, this is very important if you want to script PCP utilities. So these are the utilities which comes with PgPool, currently there are 11 utilities, and maybe we'll have more in the future. So I'll just quickly go through each one of them. The PCP node info, it just displays the information on the given backend node ID. So if you do not want to connect using the SQL client, you just You just use PCP node info and you'll get the exact status of the node. So it gives the result, it gives the host name, port number, status, load, balance, weight, status. So you can just read it out from the documentation. The next one is PCP attach node. Well, this is kind of an important utility. You can attach a backend node using this utility. And I think in the first example, we did use that utility after for manually attaching the standby to the Postgres. And what you do is if the node is somehow detached or failed because of some problem, or you want to add a new node, so you just configure that the settings in the pgpool.conf file, and eventually you use this PCP attach node utility, and that will make that node recognized as a part of the backend node cluster in the PgPool 2. So yeah, and yeah, failback command gets executed before the actual attaching of the node is performed by the PgPool 2. Similarly, like attach node, this is a PCP detach node, and it detaches the given node from the PgPool 2. So you can also provide a -- gracefully option that makes the PgPool 2 to wait until all the clients gets disconnected from that particular node. Again, this is very helpful utility, and this is effectively like you can use this if you want to do maintenance on on particular standby, for example. Then you can use this utility to detach that from the PgPool 2 so that it is no more used by PgPool 2 for load balancing and stuff, and then you can do your whatever maintenance you need to do, and then you can use PCP attach node to reattach back the same node. And if you call the PCP detach node on the primary node, that will cause the failover. For example, if you detach the working primary node, then PgPool will not ask any question. Then it will just go on detach that node. And if you attach that primary node, that will cause the failover, and the node, the cluster have to select a new primary node somehow or the other. So it is not recommended to detach the primary unless like you really want to. Then this is PCP promote node. And again, if everything is working fine and for maintenance or something, you want the old primary, you want to take off the old primary node and you want some standby to become a new primary. This is a manual way to do a failover, you can say. Rather than, so you execute a PCP promote node and give a node ID, then that particular node will become, then PgPool 2 will execute a failover, and that particular node will become a new primary node, and the old primary will get connected as a standby. So this is again, this can be used for a maintenance purpose, and but be very careful when you want to use this command. Then this is PCP recovery node. We have already did a test of recovering. This is for automatically attaching a new node or a new node to the cluster. We have already performed an online recovery test earlier in the example. So I think we have pretty good idea. Then these are PCP node count and PCP proc count. Both these are just give the different kind of information. Node count just prints the number of nodes, backend nodes currently connected with the PgPool 2, and PCP proc count displays the list of PgPool child processes with the IDs, and like you can see which child processes are serving which clients and status like this. Then this is a pool status and displays the configured parameter value as defined. Like it effectively it prints out the current pgpool.conf file values. So if you want to see which value is actually effective, you can use this PCP pool status, and you'll get the configuration values of all configured parameters. Then this is proc info, and this is just just gives the information about all child processes. And again, this one is a useful utility. You can see which, like connected database name, connected username for each single process. Process start time, connection created timestamp, and protocol version, connection reuse counter. Like this is for this is quite a useful information you can get using PCP proc info. Similarly, PCP watchdog info, it displays the watchdog status of all the nodes for, and it gives the idea, like if you have three node cluster, it will tell you which particular watchdog node is current master, and if the virtual IP is assigned on it or not, and then priority and everything like that. Okay. Then PCP stop PgPool 2, as the name suggests, it just terminates the PgPool 2 process. It's another way of stopping the PgPool 2 if you want to, like it is useful if you want to script it. For example, in certain case, if your script detects something, you want to stop the PgPool 2, then you can use this particular PCP command to do that. And it supports three modes, smart, fast, and immediate. And these are similar to the Postgres mode, like immediate kills it immediately, fast waits for the connection, and what fast and smart are kind of the same, just they just wait for the connections to like disconnect before killing the PgPool 2. So the next thing is authentication and security, and I'll just pick up my speed here because I think we are running out of time. So this is the authentication model of PgPool 2. Like client connects to PgPool 2 and it has to pass to the PgPool 2 as authentication, and then in turn PgPool 2 authenticates from the Postgres on behalf of that client. So theoretically you have to pass two authentication steps, and this is, and again from 4.0 you can effectively use different authentication methods between client and PgPool 2, and in turn PgPool 2 and Postgres. Again, this is very very useful thing. For example, you can use MD5 authentication between client and PgPool 2, while between PgPool 2 and Postgres you can use some other password authentication method. And this can be useful in particular kind of setups where maybe you want to use SSL authentication or certificate based authentication, but you still want to have a password or something like that. So yeah, you can do it, and it was not possible before version 4.0, but now you can use different authentication methods. So these are the supported authentication methods with PgPool 2, like trust. We all know this shouldn't be called as authentication, but it is a trust. Like you don't need password to do to log in. Then the MD5, then SCRAM, and then PAM, and SSL certificate authentication, and plain password authentication. These are just a similar method as supported by Postgres, and these are also supported by PgPool 2. And just like Postgres, pghba.conf, PgPool also have a similar kind of file that is called as pool_hba.conf, and it serves the same purpose as what it does as pghba does on the Postgres side. Like, and you can pinpoint the connection type, client IP range, host name, database name, username. Like you can limit the connection depending upon these parameters. Like if you want only particular range of IP to get to allow to connect through PgPool 2, then you can specify that in pool_hba.conf, and then you can specify the authentication method. Like you want to force that particular authentication method to particular IP ranges, then you can do it. Like you can do a similar things as you can do with the pghba.conf when you connect to Postgres directly. So yeah, this is the HBA record format. You can see that it's almost exact ditto copy of pghba.conf record format. So there are a few differences. This is again the example of PgPool pool HBA.conf, and Yeah, you can just see, like, you can use host name, you can use addresses, you can use IP addresses, ranges, and everything. These are the differences. So same group, this keyword is not for database field is not supported. Like in PgHBConf, you can provide same group for in part of database name, so that all the database part of the same group should match with this record. But because PgPool 2 does not have the visibility of databases, the databases exist on the Postgres side, so you cannot use the same group. But what PgPool 2 does is it matches the database name from the startup packet with the record in the HBS side, and if both have the match exactly, then only then it allows it. So it has no information about the groups and database groups, so that's why it's not possible to use the same group. Similarly, group name following plus sign are not supported, because again we don't have any information available in the PgPool 2 side. Another thing is it doesn't matter if the database or the user does not exist in Postgres. If you provide a username in pool hba.conf and the same user connects to PgPool 2, it will pass through the pool HBA pool HBA authentication step. Of course, it will fail when we'll see that the same thing is now the same user or same database does not exist in backend. But for passing the pool HBA conf, the user doesn't have to be existing, or the database doesn't need to be present on the Postgres side. So these are few differences from PgHBA. Otherwise, they are pretty much the same, and they serve the same purpose. So these are some of the best practices for securing the database. The first thing is we can consider PgPool 2 as adding another security layer to the database system, and we can use PgHBA.conf to only allow the connection from PgPool 2 IP address or PgPool 2 host name, so that there is no external access available to the to our database system. And then we can use pool hba.conf to allow access to the user. So even if something like even one of the system is compromised, again it still the users will not be able to connect to database directly. And so effectively we have two layered security using the PgPool 2 hba.conf and pghba.conf. And so this is kind of a best practice. So normally what we do is we only allow single IP access in Postgres side, and then control the users from the pool HPA. So this is the best practice in that. So pool password file. Okay. There are kind of authentication method which require a password to be present on the PgPool 2 side for us to make sure that PgPool 2 can authenticate from the server. So for that purpose, pool password file, like if you want to use MD5 authentication or if you want to use scrambled authentication, they can only work if we place the password in pool password file. And it is same, like it contains a list of username, colon, passwords in lines for each user we want to allow use scram or MD5 authentication. And you can store the passwords in any format in pool password file. Like you can store MD5 format, AES encrypted format, plain text format, or scram SHA-256 bit format. of course, if you use MD5, store MD5 formatted password in pool password file, then only plain text and MD5 authentication will work. And in case of AES encrypted password, all authentication can work without any problem, because this is local encryption, and PgPool 2 does have a key to decrypt that. So these are kind of the passwords you can store. And this is a note on using the AES encrypted passwords in pool password file. So I've touched this on in the start, that like as we know, for AES encryption we need encryption and decryption. It is a symmetric encryption, so we need a same key to encrypt and decrypt. So we need to have this key present on the system, and by default the PgPool 2 looks in user's home directory PgPool key file, and if that file is present and has an appropriate access, then whatever is written in that key file is used as a key to encrypt and decrypt. And all the passwords in the pool key file and will be encrypted and decrypted using the same. So effectively, if you don't want store the key in the encryption file in the file, you can also provide the encryption key from the command line argument, like -- enc dash key or -capital key. You can provide the encryption key using when you're starting the PgPool 2 in the command line. But I think that the best way is to use the key file and place it in some secure directory, use the environment variable PgPool key file to point to that directory from the terminal. So this is pretty very secure form of encryption, and if you keep the key file secure, your passwords are always secure. So this is the PG_ENC utility that comes with PgPool 2. You can use this utility to create and store the AES encrypted passwords into a pool pass file. So you can also provide the encryption key as a command line argument, or it can read the encryption key from the file, and it can also read the encryption key from pool key file environment variable path. And yeah, it can do pretty much everything. And like as far as passwords are concerned, if you give -m option to this, it will automatically go on and update the pool password file. Like you don't have to copy paste anything. Like it will automatically update a pool password file, which can be used by the PgPool 2. So yeah, this is just an example of like working of PgENC. I've just created a pool AES key file. I've changed it permission, like changed it to 0600. I've exported the PgPool key environment variable to point to that file. Then I've used just PgENC, then user DB name and username. And yeah, there I'll type the password, and it gives me like it is using the /home Postgres key file. You can see the AES encrypted password is stored in the pool key file, pool password file. So it's pretty easy to use the ENC utility and store the encrypted passwords. Similarly, like PgENC, we have PgMD5 utility. It does the same thing, but it stores the password in MD5 password in PgMD5 in MD5 format. So yeah, I think I'll just skip this one because we are already short of time. So this is the what pool password file is used for. It is used to authenticate clients with PgPool 2 and used to authenticate sessions with Postgres. So the pool password file serves two purposes. When the client comes in, the PgPool 2 will use the username and password from pool password file to authenticate that client. And then if the authentication is successful, then it and propose and PgPool required to connect to the Postgres using the same user, it uses the same pool password file, and it depends upon the type of the configuration, type of the authentication you are using. In some cases, it does not need a authentication pool password file to authenticate. For example, in case of clear text password authentication, it does not require pool password file. But in case of SCRAM or more complex authentication methods, the pool password file might be referred. So pool password file must use the same password for user as are in the databases. Otherwise, the authentication, the backend authentication won't work. The pool password file uses password type prefix in password string to identify the kind of password. Yeah, if for MD5 password, you have to prefix the password string with MD5 for AES, and for text, like from SCRAM, like these are the you need to prefix the password with the appropriate type of encryption the password is using. This is for the PgPool to identify like what kind of password is present in the file. So these are the configuration related to the authentication. Enable PgPool HBA. This enables the pool HBA. Setting it off will disable the HBA. It's pretty much obvious from the name of the name of the parameter. Then pool password file. This sets the location, the name of the pool password file to be used. You can use a different name if you want to. Allow clear text front authentication. Well, this is a pretty dangerous one to have, but you can, of course, you can use that. For example, if you allow PgPool to use clear text front authentication, then if some user tries to connect to PgPool and PgPool does not find the appropriate user password for that particular user in pool password file, which is required for the backend authentication, then if this variable is on, then what PgPool will do is it will ask the client side application to switch to clear text authentication. And if the client agrees with that, then PgPool will get the password from that client in clear text format. It could be SSL encrypted, the whole communication channel, but the actual password will be in clear text format stored. And then PgPool will use that clear text password to authenticate through the backend. Of course, you might not need to use that, and you need to do a proper authentication. You need to do a proper configuration in pool password file. But this PgPool does allow this clear to fall back on clear text front end authentication if it doesn't find the appropriate password in pool password file. But yeah, it's you can guess that this is the dangerous one to use. Okay, the load balancing, I think, yeah. So this is the load balancing, like write queries are sent, write requests are sent to the primary server while the read queries or read requests are routed to the standby server. This is known as load balancing. You can switch on the load balancing using load_balance mode is equal to on. That is all you need to do. So the load balance does work in replication and master slave mode, and in this mode read statement inside the transaction block or load balance until the writing statement is issued in this particular transaction. Queries using system tables, unlocked tables, and temporary tables are always sent to the primary node. And yeah, you can guess for the obvious reasons. And a select statement having a writing function called do not get load balance. Yeah, again, because we cannot execute a write function on a standby or on a hot standby because only read transactions are allowed there. Select statement inside serializable transaction do not get load balance. So yeah, I'll try to touch on the important part. So if you are using the extended query protocol, and if the parse of a select statement was sent to a standby node, because you know that in extended query mode the query is divided into multiple messages, client messages. So for example, the parse was sent to the standby node, and then the client issues a DML statement before executing the previously parsed. Then as per the as as per the algorithm of the PgPool II load balancer, whenever a write or DML is issued in the transaction, all the subsequent read query must not get load balanced, because then there's a chance that we can get a older version of data in that case if the replication lag is like on a higher side. So in that case, what PgPool does is it resends the parse, the previously routed parse message to the primary again. So this is a kind of a behavioral thing. Like then in that case, the same parse message could be sent to multiple nodes. Yeah, this is one important thing to consider. Then there are ways if you want to force a particular query to the primary node, and you can use no load balance comment at the start of the query, and this will force the query to land on the primary server. And of course the behavior depends on allow SQL comments. And this page shows the working of the no load balance command. So in the first I've used the no load balance command, the circle in red, and did a select inet server address to just to make sure which server executes that query. And if you see, the query was executed by the primary node, and because we get 172.22.0.50. and if we issue the same query without the node load balance command, then one of the standby executes that query. So you can force any query to land on the primary server by using the comment at the start of the query. Otherwise, the internal logic of the PgPool II load balancer kicks in and decides which query needs to be sent to which server. Then there are black query pattern list. Like you can put in the query, this is a configuration parameter, and you can put in the queries there, like which queries you want to you always want to send to the primary server. So yeah, and you can also use a regular expression. So I've added an example, like if I want a selects on a table NLB to always land on the primary server, I can put that select steric from NLB table in the black query pattern list, and this query will always be served from the primary. And yeah, this is just showing that the working of black query pattern list. And then how do we tell PgPool about the writing function, like which functions are writing and which are harmless to be executed on the standby? So we use byte function list and lag function list parameters. These are two parameters. They are mutually exclusive to each other. Lag function parameter list, it contains the function which are writing function. You can use the regular expression, and all the select statements who have the function calls present in the black function list will always land on the primary server. Alternatively, you can use white function list to tell that these function are reading function, and all other function other than which are present in the white function list are writing function. So this is depend upon the design of your database, like whichever configuration parameter you want to use. So I hope I'm making myself clear and just trying to wrap up things. So again, you can specify a comma separated list in the writing function, and you can also use the regular expression. And like the best practice is you can either design for the white function list or for the black function list. And what you can do is you can prefix your function name with get or set. For example, to use white function list, all the writing or the reading function are prefixed with get, And in the byte function list, you can just use a regular expression, get underscore star. This means any function starting with get underscore, that is a reading function, and you can safely load balance it. And all other function which does not have a get prefix in their name, they are writing functions. Okay, so yeah, this is just a inverse of a wide function list we have just discussed. Yeah, this explains the same thing. Like, we can use a particular naming scheme for writing or a reading function. Like, we can use set underscore for all the writing functions and prefix all over writing function with set underscore and use a regular expression in black function list parameter. Okay, so this is to ensure like we always get our latest version of data. So depending on the type of replication setting and workload requirement, load balancing can be configured to ensure we always get our latest data. PgPool provides two configuration parameters to configure the load balancing behavior depending on the state of current session. So this the first is disable load balancing on write, and the second is delay threshold. So we can use these two parameters to fine tune the settings. So disable load balancing on write, it can have four possible values, like off, always, transaction, and trans-transaction. When set to off, read queries are always load balanced, no matter you are inside the transaction, if you are like or whatever the state transaction is in. And this will give the best load balancing performance and use for a synchronous replication, because in that case your all the replicas are synced. But in case of asynchronous replication, there's a possibility like you can read an older version of data when you set disable load balancing on write. And then when set to transaction and write query appears in an explicit transaction, subsequent read queries are not load balanced until the end of the transaction. Yeah, this is the normal mode kind of a thing. Like whenever a writing query appears in a transaction, all the subsequent read queries must also be sent to primary to make sure that they get the latest version of the data. You can also set it to the trans transaction, and this is pretty hard one. Like if a write statement appears in explicit transaction, subsequent read queries are not balanced until the current and subsequent transaction in your session ends. So theoretically it widens the spectrum of disabling the load balance. And when set to always, well, it effectively disables the load balancing until the time the current session ends. So I don't know where always can be used, but yeah, we do have this particular setting. Okay. Then the delay threshold, like we can set the specific maximum tolerance level of replication delay in vol bytes on the standby server. Like we can set the setting the delay threshold to zero. This means do not check the delay threshold, but you can set it to any value in number of bytes. And if the replication delay at particular time exceeds that amount of bytes, then stop the load balancing until the delay threshold comes back within the acceptable range. So this is you can configure the delay threshold, and then it works automatically. Whenever the threshold is reached, the load balancing will stop working, and then when it comes back within the acceptable range. No. Okay, so we have already discussed SR check database, SR check user, SR check password, and SR check period configuration parameter. These are parameters which configures the database server user that is used for reading the delay threshold setting from the backend. And this we have already discussed that. So basically, PgPool provides variety of configuration to fine-tune the routing of read queries to effectively distribute the load. Routing of these queries can be also be configured on basis of connection application name, target database name, backend node, and load balancing weight. So yeah, you can, I'll quickly go through these parameters. Like you can set the application name, redirect, preference, lift. Like you can make PgPool to route a specific the connection from a specific application to a specific backend node. For example, if you want all your PSQL clients to be served from 50% from standby one and 30% from standby two, like you can specify the ratios. Like this is like this is for the load balancing thing. The right queries will always be, the right statement will always be served by the primary node, but you can set the ratio of the read queries for a particular application name, and this this is as much as you can do. And similarly, app name, this is the example of app name preference list. Like if you see on the bottom of the slide, we have used PSQL primary and my app. This means only route all the queries from the PSQL to the primary, and then I use my app 1:1, and then my app 2 standby. You can use node ID, like the my app 1. This means route 30% of the queries to the node ID 1, and my app 2. Route 100% of the read queries to standby. This is like you can use the standby as general standby name. Standby, like all the standby falls in the same category. If you write standby here or primary, you can use that, and you can also use the node IDs. So this is an example. Similar to the app name redirection preference list, we have a database redirect preference list. We can make sure like the connections to a database one should always land, be served from particular backend, and the connection for database two should also be should be served from primary only. It uses a similar format and as of application preference list, but in this case the database name is used for the comparison or as a parameter rather than the application name. And these tools are quite kind of a new parameter introduced recently, and the backend weight this is as old as PgPool itself. Like you can set the backend weight for each backend, and for example backend weight 0, then and then backend weight 1 for each. You can set the backend weight for each node individually. And you can set it to any values, and when PgPool 2 starts, it just normalizes all the backend weights and calculates the ratio, and then tries to route the queries based on the backend weight ratio. So if we see the first backend weight has the least preference, and app name and database name redirects have the most preference. If some rules get satisfied by app name or database name, then it will not consider the backend weight. But if there is no rule for a particular connection available in app name or backend or database name preference list, then this backend weight will get this rule will be used. Okay, then there is another new thing in PgPool: session versus statement based statement level load balancing. Historically, PgPool by default selects the load balancing node at the start of each session. that node is used as a destination for all load balancing queries for the lifetime of the session. This is how PgPool used to work. Until recently, we have a statement level load balancing, and setting this parameter to on make the PgPool to select load balancing node for each query when the query arrives. This is the example. Like, for example, if we have three node cluster, one is primary, two standby, whenever you start a new session, the primary node will always be there for each session, but PgPool 2 will select one of the one node from the available list of standby, from available standby nodes, to use as a load balancing node for this particular session. And you can see the true in the last column. This particular node is used as a load balancing node for this particular session, and PgPool will always use this node to route all the read queries. But now with this new statement level load balancing, what happens is rather than selecting a node at the startup, PgPool 2 will not select any standby node, and it will only select one primary node. And whenever the query arrives, depending upon the load ratio on the current load ratio on the system, it will select one of the available standby nodes and send that query to this particular node. So this is where you can change this behavior. Okay, so this is another thing, and this is one thing I get lots of questions in the query. Like, can we actually gain performance with PgPool as a load balancer? So there are a few things. Like, we all know that PgPool is a middleware, and it has its own processing and network overheads, and direct connection to Postgres perform better for smaller workloads. Like, but as the load increases, the PgPool start outperforming the direct connection. Well, it totally depends upon the type of the server and workload. So I've performed few benchmarks, and with a very small systems, and just to showcase like where the PgPool is useful. So the green line here is TPS with the PgPool 2, and the black one is the TPS with the direct connection. If we see, I've used the PgBench with 100 scale factor, and then I've done the benchmarking with 5, 15, 25, and 45 clients. And if we see with the 5 clients, the direct Postgres connection was performing way better than PgPool 2. With 15 clients, again, it was better. But as soon as we start increasing the load with 25 clients, both are performing kind of a similar, PgPool 2 and direct connection. But with 45 connections, like, PgPool perform way better than the direct connection to PG, than the direct connection with Postgres. So effectively, if we have a load on the server, then deploying a PgPool 2 in front of it and using it as a load balancer will always give a better performance. Similarly, I perform another test, this time with a 500 scale factor, and you can see the tip of point comes way early than for 5 connection. Both were performing almost same, but for the 15 clients, PgPool I almost doubled the performance, and for 25 and for 45 clients, the difference was huge. So this is the conclusion. For the smaller database sizes and smaller workloads, we don't expect any performance gains from PgPool 2. In fact, it degrades the overall throughput because extra hop between client and Postgres and processing involved on PgPool 2 side. Performance gain happens when load on a single PgPool 2 server becomes significant, and PgPool load balancer give better performance than standard single Postgres server. Whenever IO load on the single PG node becomes significant, or a processor on a single PG reaches a maximum, or a database size becomes very large compared to the RAM on the PG server. So these are the conditions when you expect the PgPool will perform better. I've also done a blog on the same, and you can where I've done a complete analysis of this performance. And this is the link of the blog. So another thing is connection pooling. I'll just I'll just list down the key points. So connection pooling is, as you all know, like it is like the client connects to the PgPool too, and in turn PgPool use connects to the Postgres, then the client disconnects rather than disconnecting the backend connection. PgPool basically pools that connection, and a connection is identified by user colon database name pair, and this is just connection pooling. And the important thing to note here is as PgPool is a multi-process architecture, so each single child process of PgPool 2 maintains its own connection pool. So if you have 100 child process, then effectively there are 100 small pool connection pools in the PgPool 2, and whichever child process gets the new gets the client connection, it utilizes its own on connection pool. So there's no global connection pool in PgPool. And the other thing to note is template 0, template 1, Postgres and regression database, they do not get cached, and they not get pooled. So these are some parameters which we can change to fine tune the connection pooling. And I think I'll just skip them, and you can just read them from the this is the point I need to explain. The serialize accept, like this enables the serialization on incoming connection. Like you might have been familiar with the thundering herd problem. The thing is, if you are using a large value for num inner children, and num inner children is a parameter which, like the PgPool 2 spawns num inner number of children at the startup. For example, if you want to your PgPool setup to handle 1000 concurrent connection, then you'll set num inner children to 1000. That means at the startup 1000 child process will be spawned by PgPool 2, although this is a very huge number, and normally we don't do that, but just to clarify the point, so each one of the child process of will be listening will be waiting for the child for the client connection. And whenever a new client connection comes in, like all of these 1000 connection will try to get that connection, and only one of them will succeed, and rest 999 will fail, and they'll come back and start their second listening mode again. So what happens is that if you are using a large number of connection, then this will cause the single connection can cause so many, like 1000 context switches, which effectively degrades the performance. So for that purpose, PgPool 2 has this configuration parameter called serialize accept. If you set it to on, then only one of those 1000 connection will wait for the connection, and once that connection child process gets a valid connection, then another basically the child process will call, will make a queue, and the top of the queue will get the connection, and then this is how it will work. So basically you should only set the serialize accept for the large number of connection, because we have done, after this parameter, we have done some few benchmarks, and it is known to slow down the performance for the smaller value of nominal children. For example, for 100 or 200 nominal children, you don't need to set the serialize accept, but for the larger value, you may need to set the serialize accept to on. And the name of the problem is the thundering herd problem, which is solved by this variable. So we are already 3 hours and 15 minutes marks. So these are show pool node commands, and this is the best practice. Each child process manages its own connection pool, so carefully select the value of max pool. Max pool is the number of database username pairs each child process can cache. For example, if you set max pool to 2, this means each child process will cache up to 2 connections. this is how you will calculate the max connections for Postgres backend. As I just mentioned, like each child process of PgPool 2 manages its own connection pool. So effectively, we have max pools multiplied by number of num init children. This is the number of backend connections we would need in a situation of maximum load. So you just multiply these max connection minus super user reserved connection on Postgres side should be less than equal to max PG pool 2 multiply the num in children plus 2. Plus 2 is for the health checking connection which PG pool 2 made. So this is a kind of a formula which you can use to calculate the the max connection value on the Postgres side. Okay, for the log output, yeah, you can PgPool use the similar log error verbosity and client min messages. These are similar kind of protocol which Postgres uses. And then, yeah, this is, I just added just in case, you can enable the memory cache on the PgPool 2 side, and then you can use the replication mode. We have already touched a little bit on this. And this is the GUI I discussed about GUI tool for monitoring the configuration. Just stay tuned for this. We are making a new, better version of the GUI tool, and it will be available soon. So yeah, that's it from my side. If you have any question, please. You're most welcome. Okay, let me read out the question. We run PgPool 2337 and use Rep Manager to manually do failover and switch over. PgPool detects these events and properly recognize the new primaries. But all client connections are reset. Client have to reconnect and then things are okay again. But is there a way to keep a PgPool children alive in this situation and make the failover transparent to client session? Well, in case of a primary node failure, there isn't a way as of now. There is one to-do item which we're still struggling to fix that, and it is to preserve the client the front-end connections and only do reset the back-end connection. But it is still in to-do list, and but unfortunately there's no way available to preserve the client connection when primary fails. But we are working on that. Per user, per database. I'm sorry, I'm not getting. Are you referring to the connection pooling or what? Briefly talk on user database connections. Can it be configured on per user, per database? No, not really. Basically, you can just set the max pool variable, and then PgPool uses LRU, like least, it removes the least recently used connection. And the best practice here is because normally the application server, they uses one or two or three users to connect to the databases. So you just set the max pool to the value like for the most number of use connections. Like for example, if your application are using two database username pairs, you just set the max pool to two, and then even if the third one comes in, then the least use will be removed. But there's no what we can call it as a pre-warm cache. There's no kind of pre-warm cache. But again, yeah, this would be a good thing to have in the future. To be frank, like if you want to have only connection pooler, then I think the PG Bouncer is a better choice when it comes to connection pooling performance. But if you want to have a load balancer along with the connection pooling, then the PG pool comes in because of its so many modules. The PG pool is a bit heavier than the PG Bouncer. So, it has a little less functionality when it comes to only the connection pooling side. But overall, yeah, the most use case of PgPool is for the load balancer. And yeah, we do have this one in list as well, to have a pre-warm or a cache on caching of something similar to the PG Bouncer. Okay, guys, thank you very much. I hope you get something useful out of this. And you can shoot any question if you have on the PgPool community. I'm pretty much pretty active on that. I've also included my email in the slide deck. So you're welcome for any question and any suggestion, and hope to see you guys soon somewhere in the world sometime. And thank you, Lindsay, for arranging this training session and everything.